Well, hello. I'm Matt. Welcome to The Good Life. I do a little radio show from my backyard in the hills of Encino. I'm a lucky guy. In fact, I'd say luckier than most. I have lots of friends that I like to call stars.
Hey.
In fact, there's one now. You probably know Ryan Stiles, Drew Carey Show. Whose line is it anyway? Black Hawk Down?
I wasn't in Black Hawk Down, Matt. That wasn't me, okay? What are you doing here?
The gate was actually open. I thought I'd take a little jacuzzi room.
I got company coming over, okay? People that matter, okay? Get up. Go.
Bubbles feel so good,
Ryan. Look, Matt, you know what? You gotta stop doing this, okay? I can't be coming home with the wife and kids and you're in my tub, okay? Just get out.
I'm not wearing nothing.
This is Meatloaf. Okay, kids, you know what time it is? It's Outlaw Radio time!
The most imitated radio station in the nation.
I'm through with standing in line for some fun to begin, but I found a good thing leaving me with a grin. It's time for Outlaw Radio to begin.
You have the great Billy Gibbons here? Yeah.
It's very cool.
He just passed out.
Hey,
that didn't sound too bad.
Huh? And the lightning of Blount.
Oh, man.
We're here with Matt.
Oh, yeah.
At the lightning of
not fat.
We got all these guys and girls in the house. Let me tell you, that's where it's at. And that's, ladies and gentlemen, Matt Allen. Pass me a gallon.
Welcome to it. Welcome to the big fat show that is known as Fancy Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, formerly Twitter, and all across the country at great radio stations. Thank you for spending some time with us, my friends and friendlies. This is this could be categorized as one of them big shows. There's been an offer made to Stormy Daniels. I think we all know who that broad is. Got a couple biggins, and she slayed a biggin by... Was it ever proven that her and Trump did it? I mean, and by the way, you know I've been consistent saying that if he had, good for him. Because she's pretty hot back in the day, man.
Yeah, but I think it's another one of those things where why would he pay? He doesn't have to.
No. This wasn't about.
You always have to pay.
Yeah, but this wasn't about paying, I don't think.
Well, why is he paying her hush money then?
Well, maybe.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
Did it finally catch up with his tattoo?
It's been a while. It's been a while.
So our producer is now turned blonde. He's now a blonde. He's now a blonde female of 22 years old. All of a sudden,
born and raised.
He is a Southern California guy. Welcome to it, my friends. The show where we have a major record producer who has offered Stormy Daniels a multi-gazillion-dollar record contract, and it's up to her now. The ball is in her court, which she's used to being a porn star and all that. But old Stormster, and I did some research. I did it, so you don't have to. And man, she's done it all in the old adult film category, hasn't she? I can vouch for that.
It's tough work, man.
Yeah, there's not a place that tongue hasn't been inserted. I'll tell you that. That old Stormster. And maybe even on Trump. And I mean, what the hell? Was he single at the time? See, I think that's the thing. He was probably married because he's been married for years.
Yeah. But more proof that Trump lifts all women because at that time, before he was running for president, she was dancing in little podunk little clubs Nobody heard of her.
She was a big nobody, and now she's being offered a musical contract, a recording contract, by a very famous producer who we will have on this show. And what really sparked my interest about Joel Diamond is that he created a little gal out of Florida named Andrea True. Remember the Andrea True connection? Ma, how do you like it? How do you like it? Yeah, and I watched that video because I wanted to reacquaint myself with Andrea True, and I'll tell you what, them are some tight hot pants.
She was an ex-porn star also.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's a theme here.
It's porn day.
Hey, and the other side of this coin is that I don't believe Joel Diamond is, and I may be wrong here, but is on Trump's side. I don't think that, like, if push comes to shove, I think music producer Joel Diamond would most likely vote for Biden. So we'll get into that, but that's not what his time spent on this show will be about.
Does he do mornings at Kiss FM? Joel Diamond, that's a great radio name.
Joel Diamond in the morning, and yeah. Here's a little Andrea True. You remember her from all the porn videos. More. How do you like it? So this is going to be great. This is going to be good stuff today. I had the weirdest stinking dream, and it was one of those dreams where it is so real. There was such reality in this dream. Now, we've all had those, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Right, where you're trying, and then you know you're in the dream and you try to get out. You know that one, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, oh, what can I do to get out of this thing? And supposedly, if you jump off a building and you land in the dream, then you die.
Yep. Yes.
I think that's an old wives' tale.
Yeah. I mean, you know, how do you prove that?
Yeah, right.
It's like Stormy sleeping with Trump. How do you prove it?
How do you prove it? There is no concrete proof. Well, the dream was, and this was so real, that my former producer of Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on Rumble, on Twitter, and on YouTube, you have to punch it in just like that, Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio. And by the way, thank you for subscribing, and continue to do so, because we'd like to stick it up old YouTube's Arsaroo, because it seems that they hate us. And so if you hate them, then you will support us for what we do. And what do? Well, we believe in freedom and liberty and the love of the United States of America, and we believe in good presidents, not bad. So who do you think we're rooting for? Enough said? All right. Yeah.
We believe in porn stars,
more.
So here's the dream. I'm minding my own business. Former producer, now dead, Rex Dale, is in this dream. And I see him over in the corner, sort of with a half smile. And then I see my brother Mart over in the other corner, you know, just sort of lollygagging around. So that wasn't much of a dream. That's just a daily occurrence with my brother Mart. He's just, you know, sort of this blissful look on his face, right? So we're on to something here. So that's reality. But Rexdale's sort of this half, and I'm thinking, but you're dead. It was that real. You're dead. What are you doing here? And he wouldn't answer me. And I thought that he came back from the dead to steal more cigars from me. Because he was known to be listen, the guy's dead, so I...
Five-finger discount.
He can't sue you, so go ahead.
Yeah, he was known to be a thief. But God rest his soul. And I do think about him, not often, but I guess in dreams now. And there's Rex Dale over there. I guess the half-smile was he was probably in my dream thinking about pilfering more cigars, and if he could find money lying around the house. By the way, I'm missing about $500 from my old house. I'm not saying it was him, but you know, anything could have happened.
Well, the one girl that he brought over, forget her name, the
blonde, right?
Very, very hot, but I mean, certifiably should be locked up.
Yeah,
crazy.
Yeah.
Dee Dee.
Those are the best.
So those are the best. She was. Yeah. But anyway. She went in your. He brought her in your room or something.
She went into my bedroom and stole what, a $100 bill or a silver dollar,
certificate or something,
whatever it was, worth a lot of money. Yeah. And then it took a few days for her to cop to it.
Come clean.
And I finally got it back. Those are the types of folks that our former producer Rex Dale sort of ran with. So the apple doesn't fall far from the producer.
We're right, over right? Ryan Stiles' house.
Whoa, take it easy with the producer.
You know Ryan Stiles, that guy.
Tall man of comedy, right. Former good friend of this show, Magic Matt's Outlaw
Black
Radio.
Black Hawk Down.
Yeah.
So we were over at his house one time, me, you, Rex, everybody. And
yeah.
Rex stood up. Here's how well Ryan knew about this, too.
Yeah.
Rex stands up,
right.
Disappears into the house, and Ryan looks at us and he goes, "And the thievery begins."
Yeah, let the thievery begin. Yeah, oh yeah. So anyway, now that we've thrown a dead man under the bus, Rex Dale, and hey, here in California, the $20 per hour minimum wage is now in effect.
Isn't that great?
Unbelievable.
Yeah. So the prices have been through just skyrocketing at your favorite fast food restaurants, not just here in California, but across the country. But specifically here in California, it is ridiculous how much it costs you for a Big Mac. I mean, I won't spend it.
$17.
Mark C.G. Boyer and I, the other day, after leaving Dante's house. Now, Dante was a very famous magician in the 1920s, 30s, and so on. He was up there the caliber of a Harry Houdini. Buddy of mine, Chris Brown, not the rapper who beats his wife, although Chris Brown beats his wife, but he's not that rapper.
Oh.
Chris,
that's a horse of a different color.
Chris Brown purchased the old Dante estate and took us over there, and we enjoyed some wonderful old fashions while smoking stogies at this great mansion. And it's beautiful. I expected it to be dilapidated. No, it is move-in quality, man. It is an awesome joint, and it has about 5 extra houses on the 2 acres of property. It's really incredible.
Any secret passageways or anything?
Yeah. You punch a thing, and it opens up, and you can tell that, a body would fit in there. Not that Dante was that sort of guy, but he was the magician that sort of resembled the devil. And I think he did that on purpose, but that was his shtick with the mustache and the little tiny goatee. And Dante was a great performer. And this mansion, as it turns out, really a beautiful, beautiful joint. So on the way home, there was no food at this joint. And I could have eaten the ass end of a skunk traveling south in a northerly wind. So I said, "Mark, we're going to In-N-Out. I don't care how long the line is." And it's the only joint that I will wait in line for a burger.
Yeah.
It's the only place.
They're fast cars.
And we did, man. It was probably 20 minutes, and I am so hungry. So I ordered a 3-by and a double-double, and I did what I never do. I ordered that animal style, so at least I'd have the 3-by without the animal style concoction. And I like them both, but I sort of like a great In-N-Out burger the way God meant that burger to be made 70 years ago. It started... And it's, the classic. You don't have to mess with it. It is so good. I bring this up because the last time I was at an In-N-Out must have been maybe 6 months ago, maybe 8 months ago.
You were with Laurie.
It's gone up $1 for a double-double. It's now $5.65 for a double-double. So I can't imagine what the 3-by was, but you would think it'd be a better deal because you're not getting the extra bun and so on.
$6.65.
Oh, $6.65?
I was just guessing a dollar more for an extra patty.
Oh, yeah, you'd think, but it's probably more like $7.75. Yeah. But Mark had a vanilla milkshake and
they do have good shakes there.
Let me tell you though.
No Coke, Pepsi.
You can't go anywhere with Mark without him effing you somehow. And I'm not saying that he's trying, but he is trying.
He doesn't have to try.
So he orders his burger. He's double double, but no lettuce?
White sauce, onions and
light sauce, onions, and pickles only. So here's how he screws me. I notice that I am missing lettuce on my friggin' double-double, my triple, right? And the lettuce is an essential part of a double-double or a triple.
Yes.
Because it's fresh and it's crispy and it's
great.
Big and it's this culmination that brings it all together for your taste buds. Yeah. And so I get home because we went home and I open it up and I said, "That son of a bitch,
He did it to me again because I want extra. It's like, just have
get it. Get it how it is.
Yeah, just get it.
Take the stuff off you don't want on there.
Right, just take the stinking lettuce. I would have procured the extra lettuce.
You're a fast food worker's nightmare.
Hey, Mark, you don't do mustard, right?
But no. light on the onions.
They baste those burgers in mustard when they cook them.
Yeah. But Mark.
That'll be the end of Mark having in and out again.
That's a pet peeve. If you want a special, go inside.
Right.
Get out of the drive-thru
lane. Right.
No, you can get it in the drive. Anything you can get anything.
No, I know
in the
you
drive-thru.
Can.
I don't
wrong.
Know.
I
but
Matt,
don't
when know. I going back to the onions really quick, I get the raw and the grilled mix.
Yeah, that's nothing wrong with that, man.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that. On this show, we will get into pronoun pukes, and there are plenty of them these days. And I promised that I would reveal my choice for Donald Trump's running mate. And by the way, it'll be the top of next hour, and we may have this guy for a couple hours. I mean, he's produced everyone.
Well, I'd like to.
From Tony Orlando to, hold on a second. This guy will blow you away, this producer who was offered Stormy Daniels a recording contract.
Neil Diamond?
His name is Joel Diamond. Oh. He's produced the likes of Engelbert Humperdinck, David Hasselhoff, Gloria Gaynor, Ike Turner, Sister Sledge, Helen Reddy, Tony Orlando, Andrew Dice Clay, and the list goes on and on. This man has accomplishments beyond belief, and now, of course, he offers Stormy Daniels a recording contract, and maybe he'll have word. Maybe she accept. Why wouldn't she accept the deal?
Yeah.
But supposedly, the deal is she has to record more the classic Andrea True song, which, by the way,
I'd do it.
Isn't this a smart time to do a remake of that song?
Yes.
I mean, it's been sampled by other songs. Yep. A piece of that song has been sampled by many, many hit records and rappers and so on.
I can't help but wonder the talent level of Stormy Daniels, and does she have a voice? Or I mean,
well, that would be a question we will pose to Joel Diamond. How does he know that she can sing? But Andrea True, was she really a singer?
Not
really a singer.
She was a looker.
Man, I was thinking this Joel Diamond guy, man, we should do that. Take some of our younger brother's music and let him listen to it. If he says he can do so.
Hey, Martin, I'll let you handle that. Okay. I've given up on our younger brother's music, okay? That'll be your thing.
Yes, I would do it.
Yeah. You go ahead and do that. And by the way, our youngest brother is an incredibly talented musician who is a big zero. A big zero. He could be worth millions right now, but he's an idiot stick. And I love him dearly.
God bless you, Mike.
Oh, you know what? I forgot that Mom and Dad watch this show. Oh, jeez.
You added the love him dearly. So.
Well, I do. I do love him dearly. I love him dearly, man. But, man, what an idiot.
They know.
With all that talent, son of a bitch. It's just incredible. So should I reveal this now before we get anti-political when Joel Diamond is here? My choice for Donald Trump's running mate. Are you ready?
Yeah.
I mean, agree or disagree?
Bated breath.
Do you have any idea who I'm going with? I mean, really, and Ralph O'Dierna, really suss this out. Who would you think? You know, not that of course, my opinion means everything, but it does.
I think I may know who you want to pick. Sarah Huckabee Sanders.
No.
Okay.
But you're right gender.
I got one.
You're right gender. Okay, Mark? Yeah.
Stormy Daniels.
Yeah. Mark C.G. Boyer, I'm afraid to ask him any questions, but Mark?
No, sir, I don't have a guess.
I had a feeling.
Well enough.
How about you, Tattoo Dave?
No, I was thinking male, so I don't have a clue who you're going to go with.
All right, get ready for this one. Get ready. Tulsi Gabbard. You heard me. Tulsi Gabbard. I think she was made for this gig, and I can't say that more than any other reason, but an important reason, I think she walks the walk and talks the talk. I think that as far as politicians go, I think that we're dealing with someone who is honest. You heard me.
And she served the country.
She served our country. She cares about her brethren, her brothers and sisters in the military. She's an attractive gal, articulate as hell, Could you imagine her in a debate? In fact, you don't have to imagine her. How about that debate over four years ago with old Kamala Dip S and the rest of them on stage, where she really just took Kamala down? And some have said that's why Kamala was not, that sort of blew her out of the water, was that debate. And it was Tulsi. This gal, what really did it for me is I watched an interview with Tulsi and who's the guy with the curly hair, formerly a Fox? You know, big name.
What? Shemp.
Yeah.
Shep Smith, whatever his name was. Shepard Smith.
You mean from the Three Stooges?
Yeah, he said Shep.
I'm talking about big name that I should know. Didn't he take O'Reilly's gig? That's the guy I'm thinking of.
That fell?
He was just fired from Fox.
Tucker.
Tucker Carlson. And
curly
what I
hair.
What I yes, he has curly hair.
Yeah, he's got a
yeah. Tucker yeah, Carlson kind of has like curly hair.
Like a fro.
Not that I notice such things on a male, but you know, it's fetching. But Tucker Carlson, I realized, he's a bit of a goofball.
Yeah, he wears a bow tie.
Yeah, but he's a bit of a.
He totally is.
He's a bit nutty too. He's a bit nutty, but I watched the entire interview with Tulsi, and I said, "Man, this chick has got her act together, and she would be the perfect vice president, because I think that she might cement those little holes in his campaign." What do you think, Ralph?
It's a good choice. I'm leaning towards Lee Zeldin, Jewish from New York. And he almost beat the governor of New York in the last election.
No, I love Lee. I love Lee a lot, but I don't think he's going to be the guy.
Wasn't Tulsi part of the Democratic Party back in the day?
Yes.
She only
switched gears 2 years ago. So I know if my buddy John Albee from Arizona, now on a fishing boat out there, he's chief engineer.
I'll say it for him.
I know if he were here, he'd say, she's still one of them.
Yep.
But I think it's different because this gal left the party because she finally had enough. She was fed up with these a-holes. She knew the party was she tried to change the party back to the old Democrats of 30 years ago, and they would have none of it.
Your favorite was a Democrat at one time, Ronald Reagan.
Oh, of course he was. Donald Trump was a Democrat. And my favorite dude, Kennedy, Senate or hold on. Who is this dude?
Oh, John Kennedy, senator out of Louisiana.
Oh, God, is he
great.
He is about the greatest dude you will ever find in politics, man.
He's so great.
He will great. And I'm going to play a little bit from him that I watched probably 20 times the other night because I couldn't get enough of him frying this little idiot stick skier, this Olympiad skier.
You showed that to me last night.
I watched it.
Oh, my God. This guy is there as an expert. And what is his expertise as a skier? He's a good-looking, blonde-haired guy who's a skier. And he's an expert on the climate crisis because in Alaska.
What exactly dialect is it?
In Alaska, his snow is melting.
Huh.
His snow, as he puts it, is melting. And so this Kennedy man fries him like a swordfish. I mean, it is the greatest.
Yeah.
And no, don't leave right now and go watch it. I'm going to play it for you, and we'll stop it down and throw in our comments as we do. Isn't that what makes us so much fun?
So much fun.
Yeah, but that's coming up in just a few minutes. I've fallen in love with this guy. I've watched him grill a lot of people.
I had to say, when I watched it, you sent it to me, and I'm like, you're a lot like him.
Yeah. Oh, you think?
Yes.
Oh, that's a compliment.
It is.
Man.
It's a big compliment.
Believe me, I accept that. That's pretty cool.
I think Kennedy insults people a little bit better.
You mean more frequently or better? I mean, what do you mean, Ralph?
With more grace.
More diplomatically. Yeah. More diplomatically.
Yeah. Hey, man, I you know what? In 2024, I decided to be more diplomatic. It ain't working? Is that what you're saying?
That's good.
And Biden proclaims Easter Sunday as a Transgender Day of Visibility.
Oh, God.
That is the greatest disgrace any U.S. president has ever done.
I thought this was a bit, man. This is rich. Come on.
Read the proclamation.
Oh my God! I mean, one of the most sacred, one of the holiest days on the planet.
Yeah, we'll dive into that in just a second or two. Plus, I'm going to play this John Kennedy snippet with us. You know, I'm a skier on the slopes in Alaska, and my snow is melting. All right, lot to get to, including one of the great music producers who offered old Stormy Daniels a record contract. All that and less in minutes on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, and the finest radio stations across the country.
Gentlemen, you're listening to Outlaw Radio. The staccato hoofbeats of a golden palomino, carrying a man who fights wherever justice needs a champion.
Magic Matt Allen.
I mean, the dude has produced Engelbert Humperdinck, old Eng. Eng was on the first year of my show, Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio, so many years ago, because he was out pimping. That's not the best way to put it, because I love Engelbert Humperdinck, but he was out promoting his own line of cigars. Do you remember those, Ralph?
I do not.
I don't either. Everyone at that time had their own friggin' cigars, including Burt Reynolds and, you know, just the roster of celebrities. And he was one of them, and what a good dude, man.
I love his stuff.
He's one of the last crooners out there. After Tony Bennett died, it's Engelbert and Jack Jones, man. I mean, pretty much, that's it. Well, hold on. Would Tom Jones be a crooner? Sorry, not really. I don't know. I love Tom Jones as well. But this guy has produced David Hasselhoff, Gloria Gaynor, Ike Turner, Sister Sledge, Helen Reddy, Tony Orlando. And I sent a note to Tony today. I said, do you know this Joel Diamond, and do you like him? And he sent me a text back. I love him. We've been friends for almost 60 years.
Oh, nice.
Wow. So that's, from a buddy who I respect in Tony Orlando. He's a big fan of this Joel Diamond, who will be here in this 1876 Virginia City, Nevada style bar, smoking, drinking, interrupt. Oh, that's the other part. I bet he's a non-smoker.
I was going.
Oh, he's coming. Oh, he's not even a foreigner.
No, he'll be here. Oh, he'll be sitting here with us.
He'll be a smoker at the end of the day.
Yeah, he will be. I wonder if he's going to use the old classic.
I'm allergic.
Yeah, that I'll tell you what. That's my pet peeve. When someone says they're allergic to smoke, that's a lie.
Well, your immediate response.
It's not an allergy. Yeah, what do I say?
You say, no, you're not.
Yeah, you're not allergic. what you are is someone who doesn't like smoke, and I understand that.
Yeah.
And I completely understand that. But you're not allergic to it. You're just, you know, and if you're allergic to a-holes, you don't want to be on this show, right?
Because there's several.
Oh, yeah. So Joel Diamond will be here on this particular show. This man who intrigues me. And, man, I want to get him on the show. I want to do a phoner with him. I've never heard him on other shows, so I don't know if he'd be up for this. But this John Neely Kennedy, United States Senator, What do you think, Ralph? Do you think he'd be up for such a thing? Or do you think that he has no time for radio when he's always sitting there and, you know, in chambers grilling people?
No, he does a lot of interviews. He'd definitely be up to it.
Because I love him, man. I think I have a sort of a man crush on this guy. But he's that good. About 71 years old. He served as the Louisiana State Treasurer from 2000 to 2017. Secretary of Louisiana Department of Revenue, in 2004, Kennedy endorsed Democrat. Yeah, this is interesting stuff. This man, John Kennedy, endorsed Democratic presidential nominee John Kerry over George W. Bush, which is sort of interesting. So another man that decided at some point this party was no longer for him. But he was one of those blue dogs.
Right, he's from Louisiana.
Yeah, and you know, there was a lot of the, did I say Shah? Shah?
Shah.
A lot of this going on.
George Spicoli.
But he was being courted by the Republican Party for months, and then he declared in a letter to his constituents that he was leaving the Democratic Party, joining the Republicans, and that happened in 2007. And in his letter, he stated that he would run again for state treasurer later that year, and What a good guy. So let me set this up. He is there in the Senate, and with this expert on climate crises, you know, he's a skier.
He's a tool.
He's a skier. He reminds me of all those, like, attractive blonde sports guys in every sort of teen movie.
Ties a shirt around his neck.
Right. Yeah.
Which sums up in one word, a tool.
Right. Sort of Missy Buffett. Yeah. And then he turns out to be the bad guy, and then the ugly kid nails him and takes his chick. You know, that movie. We've seen that movie a
Buffy
million
and Biffy.
Oh, yeah. Revenge of the Nerds.
But that's sort of who this guy is. But as he sits there with that dumb look on his face, John Kennedy has some choice questions for this man who has a real problem with the crisis. How old would you say he is? Maybe 24?
Yeah, right around there.
I was going to say.
Yeah, oh, God, these people that age, oh, they're so stupid.
But you know,
they're so stupid. They buy into anything the government throws at them.
You'll see, but he keeps going back to, well, that's not what we were talking about.
Oh, these mask-wearing sons of bitches, man. That's who these 20-somethings are. And not all of them. I mean, you know, I've seen a few who are bright, but a few. So this is the Olympiad skier, and sitting there as he's being grilled by John Kennedy. Let's go.
Who invited you here today?
I came with Protect Our Winters.
Right. But you're here on behalf of the Democrats or the Republicans?
I'm here on behalf of the outdoor enthusiasts around America.
Okay. You were contacted by Senator Whitehouse's staff?
I personally...
Democrat.
Came with Protect Our Winters, so I don't know how that went exactly.
What is carbon dioxide?
I went to high school, but that's carbon dioxide is a gas.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not a professional to talk about carbon dioxide so much.
All
but
right. Yeah.
Well, you want us to abolish it, right?
No, there's always going to be carbon dioxide.
Right. So what is it you want us to do? Let me back up, because I mean, you're here as an expert.
There it is.
Tell me more about what carbon dioxide is.
Nice.
I'm here as an expert cross-country skier who sees the changes in my winters and the landscape that I live in Alaska.
Yeah.
And so carbon dioxide is what I see it as, is, you know, it's a gas that exists in our atmosphere. Mm. And what?
Is it the major part of our atmosphere?
It's a huge part of our atmosphere, yes.
It's actually a very small part of our atmosphere.
Well, okay. But,
duh.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. What are you asking specifically?
Well, you said we need to reduce carbon dioxide emissions. I'd like to know first if you know what it is.
It's a good question.
You want us to abolish fossil fuels?
I never said that.
You never have said that?
No.
Okay. What do you think we ought to do with fossil fuels?
Pause. You know, I love that Southern gentleman way about him.
Yeah.
You know, so what do you, you know, as he's just sticking it up your hiney, You know, he's
and
just,
he has no idea. You know,
no,
no idea he's getting
stuck.
The kid
is like, what?
Oh, this guy, because John Kennedy is so friggin'
he's so good,
smart.
Yeah.
He's so smart, and he just wants to know about fossil fuels. That's all. Okay, continue, please.
What will we do with fossil fuels?
Yeah. Should we make any changes?
I would like to see a decrease in the use of fossil fuels. Yeah. I think there's a possibility to use more electric generation.
Nah. Okay, over what period of time? 10 years, 50 years, 100 years?
Good.
That's not... I would like to see it come as fast as possible while continuing...
How fast?
How fast?
Sorry?
How fast?
How fast?
I'm not... I don't have a...
You don't know?
That. No.
You okay. Know. You just think, well... How much will it cost for us to become carbon neutral in the United States by 2050?
Nice.
I'm not a professional on that. I don't have an answer.
You don't have any idea?
No.
You just think we ought to spend the money?
I'm not an economist.
Yeah, but it's going to cost money. You realize that?
You realize.
Yeah, but we've also talked about the trade-off of what the cost of climate change as emergencies will cost in the future also. So.
Right, but it's going to cost trillions of dollars to become carbon neutral by 2050, right?
Right.
I do not know.
You don't know.
No.
You just think we ought to do it.
I don't have a great answer for you, but I think I would.
If we spent those trillions of dollars and became carbon neutral by 2050 in the United States, which you advocate, how much will it reduce world temperatures?
Good question.
I don't have an answer for that.
Oops.
You don't know?
No.
You just think we ought to spend the money and then see what happens?
I think, as an athlete, I think if we spend that...
Pause. I just love, as an athlete. Well, you see, as an athlete...
You think we ought to just spend the money, see what happens?
Oh, yeah. Well, isn't that what the Democrats do? Isn't that what the woke-tards do?
Yeah.
That's what they do. They just throw money at it.
Pass it to see what's in it.
You do. You have to pass the bill to see what's in it. Now, isn't that simple? Okay, continue with John Kennedy talking to this Nimrod from Alaska, who is an Olympic skier.
Expert.
Yeah.
Money and invest in our future. Hopefully those temperatures stop rising, and maybe the snow at least stabilizes where it is for me. But,
pause.
I don't think anyone...
Did you notice that? For me.
Right.
Because the left is... Those folks are always about them. It's not about the good of our country and our citizens. It's about them. It's affecting his skiing.
Yeah, of course.
It's
the most important thing.
Well, it's melting.
My snow is melting.
His snow is...
My snow.
His snow.
All right, let's get this straight. My snow.
His damn snow is melting. Continue, please.
Knows for sure. I don't know anyway.
Well, when my colleagues invite witnesses to come to us to tell us, advise us on passing legislation, I always check out the background of our witnesses.
Smart.
Because I like to know who I'm talking to. I checked yours out, Mr. Schumacher.
Pause 1 second. Yeah, I forgot to mention the guy's name is Schumacher. Yeah. Hey, Billy, keep it down out there, man.
Joel's out there.
Trying to do a show over yee. God. So Oh, yeah. Well, there's no other way to take care of that.
No, you have to do it that
except
way.
Except live on the air. It's the only way.
Yeah.
It's the only way. We have no choice. All right. Continue, please.
And I want to be sure I understand it as I evaluate your testimony.
Pause for a second. You know, it's a blessing and a curse doing a show from an 1876 Virginia City, Nevada style bar in your backyard.
Yeah, drifters coming through.
Well, the blessing is, you know, it's a really fun bar, and we serve up cocktails and smoke cigars, and no one bitches at us. The curse is that... Grifters.
Grifters, man. Yeah.
But you're not calling Joel Diamond a grifter, by the way.
No, Billy.
And by the way, what a pro he is to be here this early. Okay, continue with this, man. In case you just tuned in, this is the wonderful senator out of Louisiana who happens to be grilling this Olympiad skier from Alaska like a swordfish. Go.
On June 8, 2020, you tweeted, I'm going to quote, "The war on drugs was intentionally created to incarcerate black people en masse."
There we go.
End quote.
Yeah, en masse.
The war on drugs, you said, was intentionally created to incarcerate black people en masse.
Mm-hmm.
Who intentionally created the war on drugs to put black people in jail? Who were you talking about?
I don't remember typing that.
Oops.
You don't?
No.
It's on your Twitter feed.
Yeah.
Maybe a retweet. I don't know. I haven't used that
however,
in a while.
Well, also, even it if it's a retweet,
I haven't used it in a while.
It shows your support.
Yeah, it shows your support.
Right?
Right.
Maybe. Yeah.
Maybe.
But it's not the topic of this conversation.
right. But it has to do with you're here giving us advice, and I just kind of like to know a little bit more about your
point. Yeah, I'm here as an athlete giving you my story and what I've seen in my
field. On August 27th of 2020, you tweeted this, quote, I'm going to quote, police are paid with taxpayer dollars. If they are not answerable to us, we can demand new service, and that's what this is. Abolish the police.
Well,
in favor of that new service.
How about,
end quote.
How about that?
You think we ought to abolish the police, do you?
Again,
do you,
not the topic I'm here to talk about today.
I know, but you tweeted it. Do you think we ought to abolish the police?
You think so?
That's not what I'm here to talk about.
Should we do that before or after we get rid of fossil fuels?
I'm not going to address that. That's...
Yeah, you don't want to address it.
You don't want to address it.
Let me ask you about one more of your tweets.
Yeah.
On August 26, 2020, you tweeted, there's a picture, I'm not going to describe the picture, but you said, quote, your words, not mine, it's on your Twitter feed, quote, this is what systemic racism looks like. The Los Angeles Police Department is literally policing only the Black Lives Matter side, end quote. What'd you mean by that?
This is still off topic.
No, it's not. You're here as an expert telling us, advising us, and I'm asking you about your background.
Right.
I'm here as an athlete to talk about the effects of climate change on my sport.
Okay, let's go back. Well, I'm almost out of time.
You're well out of time, and we have other senators waiting, so please wrap up when you have a moment.
All right. Thank you all for your testimony.
Oh, I love him.
He's like the kid is like Matthew McConaughey. All right.
Well, it's like if Andy Griffith, you know, if he's, you know, grilling you.
Yeah.
It's like, well, let me ask you why you're so stupid. Yeah, may I ask you why? And I'm not calling all skiers out. I'm not saying they're all dimwit dip-asses, but why are you so stupid? Why are you? Could you answer? Oh, I guess he's leaving the building. John Kennedy, God bless you, man. We need more like you, my friend. A lot to get to on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on Twitter, and the greatest radio stations in America, and a little piece of Canada. And Joel Diamond, record producer extraordinaire, will be here. He's the one that offered old Stormy Daniels a record contract. We'll be this after back. Thank you.
actors, would-be stars, wannabes, and people who just want to hear themselves talk. The demons of decadence, smoking, drinking, and interrupting. Live from an 1876 Virginia City, Nevada-style bar, this is Magic Matt Allen, Outlaw Radio.
All right, Joel Diamond, the man who has offered a record contract to Stormy Daniels, will be here in just a few minutes on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on Twitter, and the finest radio stations in America. Hey, Billy, close that curtain.
What is he doing? He's behind me whispering something to my ear.
I don't know. Not when we're on the air, my friend. I love Billy Dilly, but man, he needs his place in the sun, and he gets it at least once or twice a week on this show. Do or die.
Yeah. Tenacious boy.
If I didn't love him so much, I got to tell you, he'd be doing what he's doing.
His job security. Yeah, he knows you'll thank him at the end of the
day. It's true. Without him, my lighter went out, so I'm borrowing his lighter today.
Yeah.
So I love the man. Hey, old Biden proclaims Easter Sunday is Transgender Day of Visibility. I guess he did this a few years ago, March 31st, because March 31st isn't always Easter, right? So it just happens to land on Easter this year. But, you know, is it blasphemous? Yeah. This guy's if you don't mind me saying, this guy's a prick. This guy really is a prick.
Evil dipstick.
You bet.
Evil
is right. Today we sent a message to all transgender Americans. You are America, my entire administration, and I have your back. What do you mean by that?
Well, give it up for yourself.
What do you mean by that, lunch pail?
Yeah.
What do you mean by that? President Biden said in his proclamation, while boasting of appointing transgender leaders to his administration, because that's important, instead of just hiring the right person for the job, no matter what sexual proclivity they happen to be. And I don't give an ass whether you're transgender. I'm not against any transgender. Stop shoving it down our throats and certainly our kids' throats. But if you're the best man and or woman for the job, I don't care. You know, let it be. But that's not what is taking place these days. It's all about checking off boxes.
Well, I knew Corn Pop, and he was a good transsexual. No, the thing is, why, Matt? Why? I mean, why does he do this? Does he think the majority?
He's pandering. But Mark is 100% correct, and you should know the answer to that. He's pandering to his base.
Yeah.
But how many?
That's all he's doing. And then, of course, transgender people. You know, he entered the ban on transgenders serving openly in the military, calling transgender people part of the fabric of our nation. No, it's what?
No,
not
it's
even
not.
A percent? Not even 1%?
No.
So no. So the rights of all those straight people in the Army, or let's just say lesbians and homosexuals, I'm for you, man. And by the way, you know, I know this from my lesbian and homosexual friends, and yes, I have them. They've had just about enough of this transgender LGBTQ crap.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because they're part of the fabric of the nation? No. Who helped the country and its economy thrive?
What?
Less than 1%?
Yeah.
The president touted his administration's efforts to make public services more accessible for transgender Americans, including more inclusive passports that include an X as the gender marker. Oh, God. We're going back in time when people couldn't spell their name, back in the 1800s when they'd have to put an X on a contract. You know, that really happened. That really happened.
I know.
There's much more to do. Oh, there always is, President. There always is there's much more to do to completely ruin the United States of America.
Yeah.
He's urging Congress to pass the Equality Act to codify civil rights protection for all LGBTQ. We don't need it. They're called human rights. They're called rights under the Constitution. Yeah. They're rights. Why do I get so worked up about it? Because it's so easy to see through this crap. And anyone that doesn't understand, I ain't got no time for you.
Wow.
I just don't.
You don't know nothing about understanding.
One very good thing that comes out of the transgender community.
Yeah.
It'll keep you out of male prison. You just have to say you identify as a woman.
You bet your butt. But by the way, if they're all doing that, right?
Yeah.
So now it's, you know, so now you got the gangs and the, so wait, what's the difference? There is no difference. Yeah, Easter Sunday is being replaced, my friends, but not for those who use that gray matter. We know what's going on. Easter Sunday is Easter Sunday.
That's right. Leave it alone.
Yeah.
It's a big rabbit.
Yeah,
it's a rabbit. It's got big teeth. It's a mean rabbit.
Leave the rabbit alone. All right, well, we've returned Joel Denver. He used to be the editor-in-chief of Radio and Records. And by the way, Joel Denver, he was off my page a few years ago because of my political stance. And we were buddies for years. Joel Diamond, the great music producer, next on Magic Mass Outlaw Radio.
Out on the street, I was talking to a man. He said so much, but there's never mind that I don't understand. You shouldn't worry, I said, Daddy.
Hi, this is Meatloaf. Okay, kids, you know what time it is? You know what time it is? It's Outlaw Radio time!
Our main event!
Outlaw! Outlaw Radio!
Hi, this is Sean Young on Outlaw Radio.
Hey, this is Shelley Berman on Outlaw Radio. Listen, come on, listen to me or listen to Matt. If you like being bored, it's great for you.
It's Robert Hayes. I'm here on Outlaw Radio with Magic Matt, a.k.a. The Weasel. We are here to drink. We're here to smoke. We're here to interrupt. You may drink. You may smoke. You may interrupt, but I'm here to...
Live from the Lighten Up Lounge, this is Dom DeLuise saying, this is Outlaw Radio.
Hi, this is Chuck Woolery at Lighten Up Lounge on Outlaw Radio. There's lots of fun, guys. Be back, 2 and 2.
Hi, this is Gilbert Gottfried, and you're listening to Outlaw Radio, where we smoke, we drink, and occasionally we bother people who look old and weak.
Hi, this is Rick Dees with Magic Matt, a.k.a. Mr. Cigar, in the Lighten Up Lounge. We drink, we smoke, we...
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, here she comes. Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, I watched this video for the first time in a long time last night, and Andrea Marie Truden, come on now.
How do you like that, Mom?
Look, see? She's allergic to the show. Did you hear her cutting out off stage? Yeah. By the way, rest her soul, but... Look at her dancing in this video.
But if you want to know how I really feel...
Yabba-dabba-dabba-da. What a catchy little song. So catchy that portions of this song have been sampled and put in other songs and huge hit records. Again, what is it, Andrea? Yeah.
How do you like it?
How do you like it? An American pornographer. She was in adult films. Actress and singer from the disco era. In addition to her given name, she had multiple stage names, including, and maybe some of these names you will be reminded of back in the 70s when you were doing the unthinkable and watching porn. And I know no one in our audience fits that bill. I know that. Inger Kissen, Sing Low, Sandra Lips, Andrea Travis, Catherine Warren. As a singer, of course, she's known for this, which I think made it to number 4, man. This was a huge hit.
In a video, boy, she can move those hips.
Oh, yeah. It was number 5 in the UK singles chart. And this video, I was fascinated because those little hot pants, those shorts, bring it down just a touch. I got to tell you, and this man produced this woman, and watching that video... I couldn't help but wonder, somewhere out there is a camel missing a toe.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes. Oh. I mean, no, she's, well, being a heterosexual male and all, you know, I notice things like
That's
this.
That's the first thing I noticed.
Yeah. So I'm so glad to have this man minding his own business and deciding to be here with us on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, formerly Twitter, and the finest radio stations in the world. This man, Grammy-nominated Joel Diamond, has, and we'll get into all the stuff in just a couple minutes, but true or not true, I heard for the last 40 years, this song was produced to lose money. It was produced for the record company to take a little, to help them with the IRS.
Tax write-off.
Was it a tax write-off, or you don't know?
Don't know.
Why is this, I can't hear him. Get on that mic. Yeah.
Let me move in.
Yeah.
You hear me now?
Yeah.
No, I have no idea.
You really don't?
All I know, I want to do it again for this time, not tax write-off, tax income.
See, but the thing is, this has been the rumor floating for years, and then Joel Diamond steps in, as his mic gets louder there on the board, Tattoo Dave, and
makes this a huge hit. Maybe they contracted with the wrong music producer, because you know it's like, what the hell's the movie? The producers. It was supposed to be a flop, and then all of a sudden it's a giant, enormous hit. Supposedly that's what happened with this song. Number four made a ton of money. And how did you meet up with Andrea True, Joel Diamond?
I met her actually through the discos in New York, probably Studio 54, actually.
So you just sort of ran into her dancing?
No, ran into her just one-on-one. That was it.
Yeah. Did you have relations with her? That could be a guess. Okay, that's fine. It's none of my business. But, you know, we want to know these things.
It was Studio 54.
An inquiring mind wants to know.
That's well, right. Yeah, yeah. But
I like the look on Joel's face.
So that's it.
I'd rather move on to more today.
No, of course. And we're moving on. But first, we need to set the stage here that you were the man, and I just find this so intriguing, but you're the man that produced this song. When a Joel Diamond produces a More, More, More by Andrea True and her connection, what is it you're, for neophytes, what is it you're actually doing?
Trying to get people to dance. Trying to get them on the floor.
But what is it? Are you behind the board? Are you telling the engineers, no, we need more bass, we need a little more high, we need a little overdub there? What are you doing with the song?
All of the above.
Yeah.
All of the above, yeah. That's what I've been doing for the last 50 years.
He does
years.
Producer things.
So, yeah, you do. You produce stuff.
Yeah.
So
I try.
So while you're producing this song and it's the final take and you hear the song that will then be sent to the radio stations, did you have an inkling this would be a big hit?
You never do when you're in the studio. Yeah. You can only hope and pray.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what? Yeah.
All these years, same thing. All these years.
My buddy's a producer, and he says the same thing you just said.
And you know what? It's funny. I was in the studio a couple weeks ago, and I said to my engineer, I said, do you realize at this very moment we're making a record? At this very moment, just in L.A. alone, there's got to be maybe 2,000-3,000 recording studios, big, small, home studios, big, expensive studios.
Right.
And everybody in there thinks they're going to have the next hit record.
Yeah.
And take L.A.
Right.
At that very moment, times California.
Extrapolated.
Times
yeah.
the United
yeah.
States.
Yeah.
And it's a rare moment. Jimmy Iovine used to say, he said, it's a miracle when the stars all line up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, it's like it's movie stars, actors, they go through the same thing. You know, only a handful of these people will become huge. And by the way, Jimmy Iovine, one of the greats in the business,
man. He's the best. He's
yeah.
the best. Right? I love Jimmy.
Yeah.
Jimmy used to be my engineer.
No way. Wow. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. He was my engineer back in New York.
And because of old Jim, you got old Snoop Dogg. You know, he's the man.
Well, also, and remember Jerry Heller? From the NWA.
NWA.
Yeah, NWA. Yeah. Jerry put the whole thing together with Eazy-E and NWA.
Yeah.
And
Dre.
Who can Dr. Dre was, you know, they
Ice Cube.
From there. Yeah, Ice Cube, yeah.
Do you have a favorite genre? Now, be honest, Joel Diamond, because I don't want to hear, well, I like it all because you're a producer. But do you have a genre that you listen to in the privacy of your own home or your car?
Yes.
What do you listen to?
I love to listen to pop, R&B, hip-hop. I hate country music.
Oh. Yeah, okay.
I'm sorry to say. I know there's probably a lot of fans here.
Yeah.
The greatest line, remember Buddy Rich?
Oh, yeah.
Of course.
Okay, Buddy was my dear, dear friend.
Love to hear that.
Yeah. And I don't know if you ever heard the story that he was down in Nashville doing a date. And he had one of his many panic attacks. He thought he was having a heart attack. You always think you're having a heart attack, right?
Okay. Yeah.
He was having a panic attack. And the ambulance came, they rushed him to the hospital. They're wheeling down the hall in the gurney in the hospital. And he said, Mr. Rich, is there anything you're allergic to? And he said, yeah, country music.
That's funny, man.
True story.
Oh,
it was written up in all the papers. I mean, can imagine being in Nashville?
Yeah.
Can I tell you that?
Man, did I love that great drummer on the Johnny Carson show, because I know that he and Carson were good buddies. And hey. So if he was your dear friend, you must have visited his nightclub there in New York when he started that up. Yes, no, or was that after the fact?
I don't even. I'm
Buddy Rich had his own had his own joint there, and you know,
really?
Buddy, as I understand it, you knew him. I never had the pleasure of meeting the man, but you knew that he didn't suffer fools, did he?
Say that again.
He did not suffer fools, the great Buddy Rich.
What do you mean he did not suffer fools?
He did not put up with a lot of inaccurate crap, and he'd call you out on it, right?
Totally.
Yes.
Totally. And the way I met Buddy, I should date his daughter, Kathy.
Oh, okay.
And
wait a second. You have something in common with, look at the drum head.
Right up there.
Where the hell is it? Oh, over there. That is signed by my dead buddy,
Bruce Gary from the
Knack. You know Bruce Gary from the Knack? Mr. Mike Sharona?
Yeah, of course.
He dated Buddy Rich's daughter. How many daughters does Buddy have?
One.
Okay. Oh, yeah. No kidding. So now I know two people that dated Buddy Rich's daughter.
Well, there you go.
Joel, yeah. he told me.
Who told you, Mark?
Bruce Gary from the Knack told me that Buddy Rich taught him his left hand on drums, taught him how to use that left hand.
That's very possible.
Yeah.
And by the way, Kathy, you probably know, carries on the legend of Buddy Rich. They were just out here a couple months ago at the Herb Alpert's Club, Vibrato.
Oh, yeah. Great joint.
Yeah. And I went to see Kathy there, and we're still like dear, dear, sweet friends.
Wow.
And you know Herb, I'm sure, for years, right?
I dated her when she was 18.
No, Herb Alpert.
Herb Alpert.
Yeah.
You dated Herb?
Yeah. I dated Herb. Though.
Well, yeah. Today, who knows if he's transgender or not? I mean, you know, who knows?
No, yeah. I've met Herb. I'm not friends with him. I met him many times.
Yeah, but you respect what he did with a record company, right?
Oh, yeah, A&M. Oh, my God.
Hey,
yeah, of course.
Hey, back in the day, Joel Diamond, Warner Brothers, I don't know if you know a lot about Warner, but it seems to me, being a record producer, you know about all of these record companies. They were sort of known as loving the artists, and they'd give the artists enough time to finally be found, like a Randy Newman. You know, the guy couldn't get arrested for years, but the record company believed in that man, and then boom, you know, short people come out, and I learned that he was, I mean, in my personal evaluation, I think Randy Newman is a genius. But unless you have a hit record, isn't it all about the record? Isn't it all about that song?
That's a great question.
All about the song, yes?
Well, commenting on your comment just now, years ago, a record label stuck with you.
Yeah.
I worked for Clive Davis. He was my mentor.
Oh, wow.
I ran Sony Music in New York.
Wow.
And Clive, when he believed in something, he stayed with them until they had a hit.
You don't find that today.
You don't find... You're right.
No patience.
You don't find that today.
You don't find that today. And a Clive Davis, one of those geniuses who, God bless him, is still around, man. I love this man. And I talked to a buddy of yours earlier today.
Who's that?
And I said, so Joel Diamond is coming over. Do you know him? What do you think of him? And he texted back, and he said, I've known him for 60 years. I love him. Tony Orlando.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, old Tone.
I got to tell you something.
Yeah.
I talked to Tony about 2 weeks ago for over an hour on the phone.
Mm.
I mean, he made me cry. The things he said, I mean.
He's good at that.
And I don't know if he told you or not,
but
I took over his job at Sony Music, and he was the one that recommended me to Clive.
See that?
Oh,
see
man.
See that? Yeah.
And
wow.
Tony's one of my closest, dearest, sweetest friends.
He's one of the great. He's one of the great guys in the world. And P.S. I'm not doing this to blow smoke, but I think you are as well. And when I first, you know, and I talked to your publicist Ed Losey, who is the publicist to the stars, and a man that I've known for a gazillion years, and I said, we tend to lean right on this show, and I bet Joel probably leans left, and we're not really going to get into politics, but and he said, well, he may lean left, but I don't think he's a woke guy. And I said, regardless of that, I can separate talent and politics, and it has never mattered to me if someone is a talent. For example, Ed Begley Jr. I pissed off his wife the other day.
Not hard to do.
Minding my own business on a movie set, but it was Ronnie Schell, not a household name, but you know him as Duke Slater from Gomer Pyle and a bunch of movies and TV and a stand-up comic. It was a movie he was shooting at 92 years old, Joe. 92, he's still out there doing it. And we're at the movie set, and he starts in because he's a troublemaker. And he said, you know, Matt, and he says it really loud about, you know, everyone on the set. He said, I got to talk to you about your love for Trump. And it's like, oh, good. Oh, that's great. Yeah, this is excellent. So eventually, so I get into it with her. Nothing nasty. And it turns out I didn't know that she was Ed Begley's wife. I found out the next day, Ronnie had mentioned to me, you know who that was? I said, I got to tell you something. Ed Begley, politically, we're not on the same page. But I've always respected Ed Begley, A, his work, and I've always felt that he walks the walk, he talks the talk. He rides the bike. He really believes in what he believes in. Whether I believe in it or not, I like people who have convictions. So there's my story about politics. I thought I'd get it out of the way. But, you know,
feel good.
But yeah, but
better,
but
better.
Thank you for that, by the way.
But I feel like a weight is off my shoulder.
I like this Joel guy right away.
I felt a sigh of relief.
But dig this. This story is not a non sequitur. This story dovetails into this man, Joel Diamond, the great music producer. Because he offered Donald Trump's, I guess you could call her a nemesis.
Nemesis.
I don't think that's out of the question.
No, I don't think it's out of the question.
Has offered Donald Trump's nemesis, Stormy, big old, I hope you don't mind me saying, but enormous jugaroos.
The hell,
man.
Do I mind? I don't even know her.
I mean, Malone's grande. And Joel, I have always said that if indeed Trump did have a dalliance with that gal, I don't blame him. I don't blame him one iota.
I don't blame him either.
Yeah, right? Yeah, sign me up.
So, get in line.
So how does this begin? You wake up one morning and you think, well, you know, we need more again, that Andrea True song that I produced so many years ago. But how about that Stormy Daniels? How do you even know if she can sing?
Doesn't right. matter.
It didn't matter with Andrea True either, did it?
Well,
yeah,
correct.
Right. right.
We have two parts to this question.
Okay.
We got two parts to this question.
Yeah.
How I thought about it, I thought about this a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as she came on the scene, I said, it's time for Andrea True to pass the torch onto Stormy.
Right.
And they're both from the same
adult
world,
adult films.
Adult films.
Yep. That's great.
And Stormy, as you know, just had a documentary made. Mm-hmm. Previewed about a week ago.
Mm-hmm.
She wrote a book. The only thing missing from her life is music.
Mm-hmm.
A hit record.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said in my press release, I don't know if you read that or not.
Mm-hmm.
I said, you know, I've seen her on talk shows. She is sharp as a tack. She's right. Funny as shit.
Yeah.
She's really, really a funny gal.
Right.
As a matter of fact, I don't know if you ever saw the Jimmy Kimmel interview on Jimmy Kimmel.
I avoid Jimmy at all costs, but I'm not a big fan.
Okay, I know why.
Yeah,
okay. However, he's funny. Give him the credit, he's funny.
No, sometimes. I think that he's lucky like Ryan Seacrest.
Okay,
you
we're
heard
not talking
me.
About Jimmy. I need to tell you the story.
Yeah, yes.
So Stormy is on Jimmy Kimmel's show, right when the whole thing was happening about slapping him on the ass and you know, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
Right. So Jimmy says, Stormy, I want to ask you a question. And he pulls out this board with different size mushrooms on it.
Okay.
And he says, from a little tiny mushroom to a big mushroom.
Mm-hmm.
And he holds the board in front of Stormy. And he says, how would you describe Donald? Which one?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, I mean, as short,
right.
She didn't miss a beat. Yeah. She said, Jimmy, you're holding it horizontally. Can you hold it vertically? I have a better sense.
Oh,
wow.
Oh, that's smart. That's smart. Yeah, that's funny.
That killed me.
That is funny.
That was funny.
That is very, very good.
She's very quick. That is.
So I get it.
Yeah. So I really believe that she could. She's not going to be Adele, you know.
Yeah.
But I believe in her little genre and her
world, she could have a couple hit records.
Have you heard her sing?
Doesn't matter.
All right. Okay, I get it.
That's what I love about Joel Diamond, man.
Let me tell you something. I produced David Hasselhoff.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And I produced a number one album with him. We sold 4 million albums in Germany.
Yeah.
And does he sing?
Singing superstar. No. Singing superstar in Germany.
And there were a couple other examples I put. As a matter of fact, they're in the press release.
That's a good.
Phoebe Cates.
Yep.
Yeah.
Actress.
Yep.
Never sang in her life.
Right.
I wrote and produced a record for her, number one in Italy.
Wow.
For 16 weeks.
Wow.
Wow.
So it truly does not matter.
But, hey. It matters, doesn't matter. Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Well, you should talk to Marty then.
Yeah, it matters. I don't know what does that mean?
I have no idea what that means.
He meant that Marty has no talent.
Okay. Too easy. Too easy.
I'm the only musician in this room, so they bust
me. No, you're not.
That's not true. I play the shoehorn.
Ah!
It's tough to read the footnotes, though, Joel. You know that.
I'd be jealous of
now,
Dave.
Now,
really.
Here's the deal. It matters when it comes to maybe longevity as a singer. But a one-hit wonder, hell, there are tons of those who only had one hit. And I'll give you a great example, if you don't mind, and you may even know this man. Lives on a goat farm in Northern California for a gazillion years, even though he says his wife does most of the work on the goat farm. But I gotta believe, Joel Diamond, that mailbox money every month because of one song has kept him fit financially. The song "Spirit in the Sky," Norman Greenbaum.
Love that record.
Right?
It's one of my favorite records.
Hey, Joel, and you know that song. It's one of those songs that you know by the first half second of that in that guitar. You know what it is.
And I'll give you another example.
I love it.
Somebody that I produced.
Nobody
knows his name. Nobody knows his name.
Okay.
But as soon as you hear the first couple notes, first couple bars of his record, you know exactly what it is. It was called "Into the Night" by Benny
Mardonis.
Yeah.
Of course. Of course.
I produced that. I discovered Benny. I created Benny.
Okay. I love this. I love that you brought I didn't even know that about Benny. I mean, I didn't know that you were the man behind Benny.
Oh,
because
yeah.
That is a song. Well, I'm just a little baby DJ in Seattle. And that song was released two or three times over the course of many, many years. Because was it you, Joel Diamond, or was it the record company that believed in that song so much that they kept, you know, every few years it's like, okay, let's unveil this one again. And it finally became a hit. You're aware of this, right? You don't know?
I'm more than aware of it. I created it.
He created it.
So you know the story of it. Yeah.
Okay. If you look in Billboard magazine history, there's probably about 15 artists that have only 15 artists that have had a top 10 record twice, same song, same artist, which includes Queen, which includes Bill Medley of Righteous Brother, all those hits. Benny has now been officially, which I'm making people aware of, been on the Billboard charts with that song, him singing, 5 times.
Wow, so it's been 5 times.
Wow.
5 times, in one form or another, yes.
Man, I just love that. Was it this song must have been used in a movie or a TV show.
No.
No?
It was only in Breaking Bad one time. But I'll tell you how it happened the second time when it went top 10, a big hit.
Right.
You remember Scott Shannon? The DJ?
I think he's channeling himself through me. Hey, Magic Matt, let me ask you something about Z100. you're working for me doing afternoons on the biggest radio station in America, but let me ask you a little something. This is him on the phone while I'm trying to perform an afternoon radio show on the biggest radio station in America. Say, let me ask you a little something here. In the minute Scott Shannon, as a disc jockey or radio personality, says, I want to ask you something, you know you're in trouble. And he said, let me ask you, are you trying to F up my radio station? Click. So do I know Scott Shannon? I guess I do. I want to continue this story with Scott Shannon and the great, because I love, he's one of my dearest friends, and the great Joel Diamond, master of music producing, when we return on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, a.k.a. Twitter.
And you know those really good radio stations that carry us? God bless you. We'll be this after bat.
Outlaw Radio listeners, this is Tattoo Dave, just reaching out to say thanks, tell you how much we love you. We've got the glorious Joel Diamond, world-famous producer, here with us today. Hopefully you're enjoying that. All you listeners across the nation and watchers on Rumble, YouTube, Twitter, thank you so much. Keep subscribing, and we greatly appreciate you.
We stand for fun. We stand for great cigars. We stand for the perfect martini. And we stand for the American flag. We are Outlaw Radio with Magic Matt Allen.
What do you think of that, Joel Diamond? We stand for the American flag. What do you think of that, Joel Diamond?
I'm with you.
Did you hear that? He was a little low, but he said, I'm with you. And I knew. See, I'll never ask a question unless I know the answer. Well, sometimes, but not that time. I know Joel Diamond is a patriot. He's an American. America has done well by this man, and vice versa. You know, because of him, we get to hear really cool stuff. And yeah. Engelbert Humperdinck, which I'll get into in a few minutes. I love Eng. Love Eng. Love that man. Yeah, I met him years ago when I first started this radio show, and he was out hawking his own brand of cigars. Joel, were you aware of that?
I think I remember that.
Yeah. And you know, he's one of those great guys. Still on stage because it pops up on my smart TV sometimes, and he's sort of dancing with the girls out there. I was born 100 years old, Joel. So you know, we were talking off mic a few minutes ago about my dear, dear friend, Milton Berle. And you mentioned Milton and the fact that, because we were talking about, you know, Joel said, well, wait a second, so people can watch me on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, via Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio, and you have to punch it in exactly that way, because the fakers out there, if you just put in Outlaw Radio, you'll find a myriad a-hole rip-offs. Where was I going with this? Engelbert.
Milton Berle. No.
Oh, yeah. And so Joel said, well, you know, what about makeup? I may need some makeup. He said, remember Milton Berle, you know, back in the day when he'd say makeup, and then they'd come out and this big poof of, and then the white crap would go all over the place. And I got to tell you, Joel, anyone that knows and loves a Milton Berle, I love to death, because those classic guys are not they're not in the vernacular of anyone under 50 now. You know, pretty much.
Yeah.
Those people don't exist. Those are the old guys. No, you can learn. I've only learned from people 20, 30 years older than me my entire life.
Yeah, but somebody asked me, how old are you? I say, I'm every age.
You are, yeah.
I've been every age. I've been 30, I've been 40. I've
that's right.
Yeah,
I like that answer.
That's a great answer.
Yeah. And by the way, I produced Milton's last recording.
Did you really?
Yeah. Artie Butler and myself did it, and it was called Growing Up, It Can Be Fun. It's so cute. It's a message to kids.
Oh, that's nice.
Can we get it somewhere, like YouTube or something? Can we find it?
I actually have it on YouTube, yes.
All right.
Oh, good. I will look
it up. We'll watch it.
Growing Up Can Be Fun. Yeah.
And by the way, those of you watching us right now, don't go find it right now.
No.
Just wait. Wait until.
Well, Matt, one thing you said about Milton.
Wait until after the show. Yeah, that's my
show's over.
Joel Diamond, my brother Mark.
Marty, he also said that he was really about. He dressed to the nines all the time, no matter what.
Always dressed to the teeth, man. Yeah.
Classy on stage, off stage, whatever. And he talked about Don Rickles, I think it was, or something.
No, Mickey Rooney.
Mickey Rooney.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, we'd get together, Milton Berle and my own self would get together. And I'd say, let me pick up the name, but nobody knows who it is anymore, as I just mentioned, under 50. But a legend, and the man that sort of responsible for television as we know it. And this man was brilliant beyond brilliant. And what was your point, Mark?
No, the way he dressed, talk about Mickey Rooney.
One day we got together at the Friars Club in Los Angeles, which, by the way, I was sort of sorry to see it go, but not really, because I never loved it aesthetically like the great Friars Club in New York. Now, that's a gorgeous joint. That's the old wood, it's like the man's hangout, smoking cigars, eating big steaks.
Freddie Roman, remember?
Oh, hell yeah, and having a happy damn day, Joel.
Yeah.
But this one in Beverly Hills, they foo-fooed it up, and it was too bright, but I would get together there twice a week. And one day, he's just pissed off. I said,
well, he had a bad temper.
I said, Mel, oh,
yes,
yeah.
Yes, he did.
But thank God, never toward me. And I said, what's honking you off today, Milton? And he said, hey, did you see Mickey? I said, no. He said he was on Larry King. And the guy's wearing friggin' sweat, a sweatsuit.
He said, that son of a bitch. That son of a bitch. He said, it's showbiz, man. It's showbiz. You dress up. You don't wear a sweatsuit. What a sleazy thing to do. And I said, so you don't like Mickey? He said, he's a genius. because Milton Berle truly believed Mickey Rooney was a genius. Yeah. And that's the thing about, we were talking about suffering fools earlier, and that Buddy Rich never suffered fools. Milton Berle, same way, would not suffer fools. And Buddy Rich, there's a, I guess, some sort of a segue between Buddy Rich and Andrew Dice Clay, and you produced one of Andrew Dice Clay's albums, right?
I produced Andrew Dice Clay's last comedy album.
Wow.
And I still talk to him all the time. Mm-hmm. And
he's a good dude, isn't he?
Very.
He's a good dude.
Yeah. And a couple weeks ago, he had the privilege and honor, he performed at Carnegie Hall.
Wow. Nice. Yeah, that's nice.
He called me the day before. He said, Joel, I'm doing the morning show. What should I say to them? Mm-hmm. At Carnegie Hall. I said, I'll tell you what you say. He said, first is Enrico Caruso, Stravinsky, Judy Garland, Billie Holiday, and now foul-mouthed Andrew Dice Clay.
Perfect.
And he said that on the morning show. It was great.
Oh, I love that. Yeah. I love that. And the fact that you knew Buddy Rich, the great one of, well, arguably the greatest drummer of all time, and Buddy, and you were, of course, tethered to Buddy Rich's daughter for a while.
How do you mean tethered?
But
what do you mean by that?
What do you mean by tethered?
Explain.
I think Joel being sort of a grown up and all. I bet he knows.
I bet you.
But Joel Diamond, you were dating Buddy Rich's daughter,
Kathy.
And Buddy Rich and Andrew Dice Clay had a chemistry. And what was that about the two of them?
Andrew worshipped Buddy's drumming. And when he was at Carnegie Hall, he told me he channeled Buddy. He played drums on stage at Carnegie Hall. It was amazing.
Was it Buddy who taught Andrew how to play?
I believe it was.
Wow.
I believe it was.
I've actually seen Andrew play before, and he's not bad.
He's not bad at all.
Yeah.
And by the way, I went to Buddy Rich's funeral, and I have never in my life seen such a star-studded funeral.
Oh, I bet.
Oh, from Sinatra, yeah. Jerry Lewis.
Yeah.
Johnny Carson was, it was just amazing.
That was a man who had tremendous respect because he deserved it and wasn't, as we pointed out, Buddy Rich was not the most diplomatic sort. And I loved him for that.
Yeah.
I appreciated him for that. Because, you know, this is what's going on in the wokeness of today. And the way I describe being woke is never having to apologize, never having to say you're sorry, and never telling the truth. And I love a dialogue where there's a lot of truth involved. And a Buddy Rich, I will tell you this, and I'm sort of stepping out because I didn't know Buddy as you did. That guy would not be woke because he always said it, always told you what was on his mind. Did he not?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, I have a video. I think I put up on YouTube, actually, of Buddy and Kathy in my penthouse in New York City. And I just released my new disco album. I was the artist.
No, and hold on. You're singing?
Yes.
How was it? How were you?
I'm shitty. I was a pretty good singer, actually.
Yeah?
I was a pretty good singer.
Right.
I was a recording artist on 5 different record labels, including Casablanca and Sony.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So Buddy and Kathy were up in my apartment.
By the way, is that how you know Scott Shannon? Scott Shannon, the greatest radio program director of all time, Michael Scott Shannon, who worked for Casablanca for a while.
That's right.
He did.
No, now we're jumping around, but it's. I'm glad you brought him up because it was Scott Shannon who was responsible for Benny Mardonis in Tonight going top 10 a second time.
Is that right?
What happened was that Scott Shannon, I think it was in Denver maybe at one time, right? And one night he was doing a show about one-hit wonders. And he was playing one-hit wonders. And he played Benny's Into the Night. And Scott told me himself, he said, the phones lit up like a Christmas tree on Benny's record. And the next morning he said, yeah, I'll try putting it on again. And he put it on again, and that's how it went top 10 again.
Wow.
And then I called Mike Curb. I said, Mike, let's come to the table.
Yeah.
Let's put it out on your label. So, like I said, he's on 5 different labels, only one in history.
That's unbelievable.
Wow.
Yeah.
You do you still own that penthouse in New York?
I was going to say, being from New York, there's no greater statement than my penthouse in New York City.
You got that right, Ralph. I mean, that's beautiful. And but coming from Joe, see, right off the bat, this man is an affable, humble man who has done everything and has accomplishments beyond the pale. But a humble, good dude.
Thank you.
With a penthouse in New York.
Manhattan.
Now, do you still own this joint?
The woulda, shoulda, coulda's.
Oh, okay.
First of all, I lived there 20 years.
Yeah?
It was the penthouse in 220 Central Park South.
Oh, wow. Just stop it already.
Jeez. At the entire top floor of the building.
Holy crap.
Four terraces on
you,
each
you were
side.
Doing okay. Huh,
let me tell you, this record producing biz, yeah. Not a bad biz, you know, if you're really good at it. Yeah.
Yeah. And Don Hewitt, creator of 60 Minutes, mm-hmm. lived below me.
Whoa.
And
he
always wanted. I had legendary parties up there.
Whoa.
As a matter of fact, I'm sure you did. Oh, yeah. Leroy Neiman, Andy Warhol.
Wow.
It was amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
So after 20 years, I got a really good offer out in California. I said, you know something? I think it's time.
Mm.
Little did I know.
Yeah.
Little did I know.
Of course.
And there was an article 6 months ago in all the newspapers that Beyonce and her husband, of course.
Who the hell is she tethered to?
Something.
Yeah.
Jay-Z.
Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Beyonce and Jay-Z, it said in the newspapers, bought the second biggest residential sale ever in the history of the country.
And?
It said second. And then it said the number one was the penthouse 220 Central Park.
So. No freaking way.
Oh, my God.
$240 million.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, God.
Wow. Oh, Joe.
It is a woulda, coulda, shoulda.
Woulda, shoulda, coulda.
Oh, yeah, man. But, you know, your buddy and my buddy, Tony Orlando, has stories like that. I think, all of us not all of us. I'm the dumbest guy when it comes to real estate. I have lost fortunes. You know, I planned it correctly, but then things happen, like divorce. You know, that'll nail you. You are officially divorced now, Joel?
God willing, officially divorced.
God willing? But I mean,
praise the Lord.
Okay, you are?
Hallelujah.
December 5th, 2023, officially.
All right, congratulations, my friend.
Thank you.
You were married to a very beautiful woman who was on Knight Rider. Maybe I'm wrong with this, but was she not on Knight Rider with David Hasselhoff?
Yes.
So did you meet her through David because you produced David stuff? No?
No.
No connection.
I met David in New York City, in the penthouse, as a matter of fact.
He was engaged
to a girl named Catherine Hickland.
All right.
And I knew Catherine because I dated her when she was 17 years old.
Hold on.
How old were you?
When she was. So
what?
This is later on.
I was about to call you Jerry Lee Lewis.
No, hardly.
Yeah.
This is like years ago.
Okay, of course.
Years and years ago.
Yes, Joel.
I was 18.
Okay,
19,
okay. All right.
So anyway, she was in New York, and she said she was doing a Regis show at the time. And she said, I want to come up and introduce you to my fiancé.
Mm.
I had no idea who she was engaged to.
Mm.
So she came up to the penthouse, and she was engaged to David Hasselhoff. And he walked in, he saw my gold and platinum records. He said, All I ever wanted to do was sing. I didn't want to act, I wanted to sing. And he got turned down at every single record label.
Right.
Nobody wanted him. I said, David, this is before Baywatch, after Knight Rider.
Right. Right.
He was sort of in between.
Yeah.
So I said, David, just from me, who you are, you should be able to sell money. He said, nobody would believe it. Anyway, make a long story short, I took money out of my pocket to produce him. I had my label distributed at that time with Sony, and I heard Andrea True.
Yeah, but he'll play the intro over and over. Go ahead.
Okay. So I said, David, let's go in and record a record.
Uh-huh.
So I took money out of my pocket, and
See, this music's throwing him off.
It's throwing me off.
Okay, hold on. We'll continue the story when we return because I want to hear about it. And also, there's more to this penthouse than meets the eye. Remember the payola scams? We'll get into that next on Outlaw Radio.
Outlaw Radio.
Minding our own business, sitting here, standing here in an 1876 Virginia City, Nevada style bar with a man that has offered Stormy Daniels a record contract. And all she has to do is sing more, the classic Andrea True connection song, and then boom. She's in. Have you heard back from the folks, her people, Joel Diamond?
Not yet.
Okay. I mean, it's not like you don't have credits. You have credits. I mean, you're not some schmuck off the street saying, I'll produce you. You've done stuff, like really good stuff.
I'd say so.
So it's like they should at least get back to you. And by the way, why not?
Why not is correct.
Right? What do you... Wait,
she has nothing to lose. I'm paying for it.
No kidding. So, yes.
Yeah. And I got to tell you something. If she says yes,
yeah,
that will be the biggest media frenzy ever in a recording studio.
I was just thinking about that.
I mean, could you imagine her in a recording studio?
And P.S. I listen.
And we'll outlive her Trump controversy, too.
Oh, no. Big time. Yeah. Big time.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Yeah. And so many of those who enjoy... Well, okay. So many of those who put up with us, Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio, through all of our mediums and the greatest radio stations in America, they know that we tend to lean conservative. Why? Well, I'm a big lover of the United States of America, and I ain't woke. I'm more of a pragmatist than I am a Republican. I'm a pragmatist. I love America. I love what she's done for me. I've always believed that you, whatever the hell it is you want to do, this is the country that will allow you to do such a thing, as I think has happened with the great Joel Diamond. And so when the Stormy Daniels thing, and Joel is the man proffering a concept to Stormy about re-recording the great Andrea True song, More, 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 you know, at first blush, I'm thinking, well, what are they going to think? Are they going to think, well, I'm siding with Stormy? No, I've never had a problem with Stormy. I've never had a problem with Stormy. I really do. I mean, do you, Ralph? I mean, really?
No. And Matt, you were good friends with Al Goldstein. So for anybody to say that you were just pigeonholed into one direction, it's not true.
Right. Hey, I got a question for Joel.
Yeah. And I got a question for my producer, Tattoo Dave. Why does his microphone sound better than anyone else's?
That's on you, buddy.
Okay, go ahead.
Hey, Joel, have you had any response from Stormy regarding this?
I just asked him that.
Maybe the producer was paying attention.
No, I have not.
Yeah.
But I'm waiting probably about another week or two.
Yeah?
Yeah, after the press has been saturated with me.
Then you're going to go kidnap her.
It's unbelievable. All over Europe, this offer went viral.
Yeah.
All over the place.
Oh, I know.
Well, you know what, Joel? I believe, I mean, myself, that something like this would be huge. Be huge. Because the media press right now.
Here's the thing.
It would be cute, and it would be appropriate.
At some point, yes. Joel Diamond, yeah. you may need to rescind the offer and then offer this gig to me. I'm a singer. And
can you shake your hips?
Let me tell you something. You put some hot pants on me. I got a knuckle like there's no tomorrow.
he'll make it a camel.
Oh man, I am not one to boast. I know that we don't have enough time in this segment, but I'll just hit this and sort of tease this, because I find this so interesting that during break, Joel Diamond, multi-platinum and twice Grammy nominee, Joel Diamond, the king of the music industry. Well, Clive Davis is the king, so you're the second king, I guess, if you don't mind me
the
saying.
The crown prince.
Prince. Yeah.
Even my name in the same sentence as Clive.
Yeah, no. I know. I'm with you there, man.
Yeah.
But we were talking at break, and he said, well, Matt, you know Joe Isgrow? And I said, do I know Joe Isgrow? Being in the radio business as many years, since I was 12 years old, do I know Joe? And the whole payola scam and something that doesn't exist today. And I'll tell you, I almost associate this with the mob running Vegas. I thought it was a classier place. I thought mob bad, they killed people. Yeah, I understand all that.
They were bad people.
They were bad. Yeah. Well, Ralph knows his dad was in prison because of the RICO. But here's the deal. I sort of put that payola thing in the same category. For me, it's nostalgia. And I don't look at it as nasty as it was. And I'll tell you, I'll give you some personal anecdotes about me being offered money, cocaine, to play a song on the radio. And Joel will certainly speak to that when we return on Outlaw Radio.
Wanna buy a new car? But the price ain't right. Ain't that gold? Be a damn sight cheaper. Yes, it do. Start riding the bike. Listen. They're making milk out of powder. Yeah, they are. Got the babies crying. Poor baby. They know what that stuff is. Rent's going up higher. Yes, it is.
I'll be here tomorrow.
Lord, it's a real motherfucker, yeah. Make you wanna run for cover, yes it will. And if you look, you will discover, yeah. Lord, it's a real motherfucker. Good dog. Got to go to a disco. Throw your troubles away. Dance to the music that the DJ's
don't sound too good.
Kids, you know what time it is? You know what time it is? It's Outlaw Radio time!
The most imitated radio station in the nation.
I'm through with standing in line for some fun to begin, but I found a good thing leaving me with a grin. It's time for Outlaw Radio to begin.
You have the great Billy Gibbons here? Yeah.
It's very cool.
He's amazing. I mean,
he just passed out.
He's dead.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hey, that didn't sound too bad.
Huh? The lightning bolt lounge. Oh, man. We're here with Matt.
Oh, yeah.
At the lightning bolt
that.
We got all these guys and girls in the house. Let me tell you, that's where it's at.
And that's, ladies and gentlemen, Matt Allen. Pass me a gallon.
That has produced 47 gold and platinum recordings, over 100 charted Billboard records. The man is Joel Diamond. An esteemed honor and a pleasure to have this man in the Lighten Up Lounge, in 1876 Virginia City, Nevada-style bar. Here are the hills of the San Fernando Valley, spitting distance from Hollywood, where all them wokens live. Be mistaken. Yeah, I'm digging this guy, man. Digging this Joel Diamond. Knew I would. I'm usually right about these things, not one to boast. Joel Diamond, not only a twice Grammy nominee, but just a swell dude.
I saw a smile on his face when he heard Billy Gibbons. He was over a couple of times.
Oh, yeah.
Billy.
ZZ Top, one of the
great
greats.
Guy,
one of the great dudes of all time.
Hey, by the way,
he told me, he said it was on the show. And I said,
you hit something on the board there.
I said, how do
come
you?
Come on, Dave.
No.
Help me. Yeah, you did.
How do you make that?
That's why I'm hearing crap in the background here all of a sudden.
You're interrupting Marty.
Yeah, go ahead, Mart. And I mean that sincerely,
because okay.
I have to head over there. No,
I got it.
Okay.
So anyway,
even though didn't Tattoo Dave just say I didn't?
I did, and I got it.
Okay, so
it's fixed.
Let's not do that anymore, Mart. Go ahead.
Moving on. So Billy Gibbons is over at the house doing an interview. He stayed with us all night. Great
guy. Can you believe?
Whatever. So I asked.
Can you believe radio stations play this show? I mean, I mean, God love you.
They love us.
You know, God.
I hope.
Okay, Ralph, I'm going to ask you.
Yes, sir.
Because you served him bourbon.
Oh, boy.
Our producer is drinking copious amounts of bourbon, right?
It's only 100 proof.
Hey, Joel Diamond, would you allow your technicians, when you're producing great songs, would you allow them to drink on the job?
Only once.
Okay. I'm pretty sure you insist on it.
Okay, my brother Mart. Yeah, go.
So I was going to get back to a story after he interrupted.
Could you just, when I say now action. Mart, action. Now you just go into
said,
it
Billy,
or don't.
Do you...
I'm going to interrupt him again.
Yeah, okay.
I'll tell you later. I'll tell you off the air.
By the way, I just want to say welcome back, Marty. You quit last week. It's nice to have you back.
No, it is. I like my brother Mart here on the show.
I'll quit again today.
I know, we know.
Okay.
Oh,
we know.
No respect.
Okay, let's distill this down to the man that is now that has offered Busty Buxomsons a record contract if she'll simply record the song More, 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 the classic from Andrea True. And Busty Buxomsons has not gotten back to you yet, but there is hope, right? It was only a few days ago you proffered this, correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
Page 6, New York Post.
Yeah, no, I know that. And yeah. Page 6 still in New York is, you know, it's one of those last bastions.
It's a gospel.
Of where you could get ink on your hands and still enjoy reading. You know, it's one of those last things, right, Ralph?
Yeah, and everybody wants to be on Page 6.
Everybody, including, and so, you know, my ego wanted to keep, but I got to tell you, I've been in there a couple times, and it was an honor to be in Page 6. What?
That's your brother.
I know. That's Brother Mart. By the way, our Tattoo Dave, our producer, not the only one indulging in bourbon today.
Thank you for that.
But I will tell you this, that this man with a penthouse in New York, he mentioned that an agreement happened in that joint that he wishes he still owned. There's so many, you know, in our lives, you know, as real estate moguls, we wish we had owned or still owned X.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I think it's life. It happens more than it doesn't. You know, it's only Trump who has made a fortune, man. And by the way, this evaluation of his thing and the fact that he's going to court and he has to come up with you, I bet you know that's a crock of crap. It's because he's running for president, right, Joel? You don't want to go on record. I just know that you know.
If you know,
Okay. Okay. See, Joel Diamond.
Very diplomatic.
But this is why Joel has been top of his business,
yeah,
music producer for so many years.
He's and he wants Stormy.
No, he's smart. He's so smart.
Diplomatic.
Yeah, yeah. But Stormy Daniels, I can't wait for her to say yes.
I can't wait either.
And you produce her song. That would be awesome. Now, back to the penthouse in New York. There was a deal because this man asked me, so Matt, you Joe Isgro? Yes. Joe Isgro was a classic independent record. We called them back in the day, we called them record pigs. They were record promoters. But explain, because you know better than anyone, what an independent record promoter back in the day, because it doesn't exist today, because damn it, there are no records. The only ways the bands make money now is by touring. It's not selling merchandise. It's not the song anymore. It is the song that gets you into the seats. But the only way, yeah, is merch and the touring. But back in the day, there was money to be made on hit records and the sales of hit records. And Joe Isgro explained an independent as opposed to the big labels who would hire the independents to get their song on the radio.
Very well said. That's exactly correct. Yes. And back then,
how did it work?
Back then, you had different individuals promoting different territories. You had do you remember the name Freddie DiCipio?
I know them all. Billy Brill?
Well, I don't know Brill.
You don't know Billy?
No.
Okay.
Freddie DiCipio controlled Philadelphia.
By the way, let's see, DiCipio, Italian much?
Ends in a vowel.
Ends in a vowel? Yes.
Okay. So there are certain record-breaking markets. Philadelphia is one of them, Freddie DiCipio. Then you had Boston,
yes.
Jerry Brenner.
Yep.
Then you had Buffalo, Jerry Myers, who broke After Loving for me,
yep,
up in Buffalo.
Yep.
And you had Ernie Phillips out of Dallas. Anyway, all these guys had their own territories. And the record labels would hire them for special promotion.
Right.
Because they knew how to get records played on the big 50,000-watt clear channel stations.
And how do they do it, Joel?
Well, I don't know.
Yes, so, you do know, Joel. How did they do it?
They did it.
They don't exist. The independent record guys don't exist today.
They don't exist.
So it's okay for you to...
No, that's okay. So so what happened was, the guys were starting to step on each other's territories.
Yes.
So they decided they'd all form a thing called the network, which is very famous, quote, network.
Right.
So they all came into New York to meet, and nobody wanted to meet at anybody else's hotel because they were afraid it might be bugged.
Of course.
So Jerry Myers from Buffalo called me, said, we are all in New York. Could we meet on your penthouse terrace? And I said, of course you could.
Of course.
So I got to tell you something. It was something to behold. They all came over, and they all have their big Goombas. Freddie DiCipio had this giant bodyguard with them. They all did. And they met on my terrace in New York City, and the network was formed on my terrace.
Wow.
Where they would meet and decide who was going to do what.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Does that sound familiar to you, Ralph Odierna?
I was going
to
say, it wasn't just radio stations. Back in the 30s and 40s, jukeboxes.
Oh, yeah, big time.
To get the record onto a jukebox.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, big time.
Everything happened at your penthouse, didn't it? Everything.
A lot of good stuff. Yeah.
I was.
You know the name Tommy Silverman? Tom Silverman.
I know all these guys.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I mean, Tommy Silverman had a magazine called Disco Report.
Yeah.
And to this day, I mean, Tommy's hugely successful, and to this day, every time I see him, he said he remembers the day he came up to interview me for my disco record. And he walks in.
The one you sang on.
The one I sang on.
Yeah.
And he walks in and he sees all these guys on my terrace. He knew every one of them. He said, oh my God. What are they doing out there?
No. Where are they hiding the machine guns?
More and more and more became no.
Yeah, this. Speaking to that, you went to Jilly's in New York City. Now, Jilly was a dear, dear friend of the great Frank Sinatra. And Gilly's Club was notorious in Manhattan. And there was a guy named Fat someone.
Fat Andy.
Fat Andy. And please tell us this story.
I was producing Jay Black from Jay and the Americans.
Where they had a few great hits,
by the way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tons.
Yeah.
Just a few.
So after one of the recording sessions, Jay said to me, let's go out for dinner after the session. I said, great. He said, my uncle is going to take us out for dinner.
All right.
I said, okay, what's his name? Fat Andy.
Right.
So, okay. So we go into
Certainly Julie's. Not an Irishman. Not with a moniker like that.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we walk into Julie's, and it was like, when we walked in with Fat Andy, it was like the parting of the seas.
Uh-huh.
And we sat down at a corner table somewhere.
Yeah.
And Fat Andy, like a lot of other people I knew, would never, ever have his back to the door.
Right.
There were a couple people.
You just don't do that.
Yeah. I remember Roy
Raiden. It's a bad view.
Roy Raiden. Remember Roy Raiden, the name at all?
No.
Okay. Yeah. So we sat down, and I said, and we're having just a nice casual little conversation. I said,
you're minding your own business. Joel Diamond, you're minding your own business.
So I said, Andy, what do you like to do? I said, what's your favorite thing? He said, that voice. He said, my favorite thing is, and he thought about it for a second.
Yeah.
He said, my favorite thing is hearing somebody take their last gasp of air for the last time.
Oh! Jeez. Ouch!
That's his favorite thing.
My friends, this is reality. This is what happens. It ain't all unicorns and rainbows.
No, not in those days. And how about Morris Levy?
Wait a second. I know the name, but tell me.
Roulette Records. Oh, Tommy James and the Shondells.
Oh, hell yeah.
I mean, Morris was my partner on my album with Sony Music.
And what happened to him?
Took his last breath.
Is that what happened?
Well, he died of cancer. Ultimately, he was going to prison.
Yeah.
And he died of cancer. Some people today think that he's still alive and he faked his death.
What do you think?
Who knows?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But Tommy James, I used to produce Tommy James also. Yeah. Shondells.
What a talent.
Oh, my
yeah,
God.
Yeah, man. Love that. Love it.
And Tommy wrote a book called Mob, The Mob, Me, and Other Things. And, I mean, it's a true story. People forget when Tommy James had his first hit, he was 14 years old.
Yeah, scary.
Was that I Think We're Alone Now?
No.
Was that the first? No, that was not
first one was Hanky Panky.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what happened was that Morris had an A&R guy out in Pittsburgh.
Explain A&R.
It's called Artists and Repertoire. They would like seek talent.
Right.
Right. And he went to Morris, his A&R guy, said, there's a record at Pittsburgh. It just went to number one. Everybody's talking about it. Nowhere else except Pittsburgh. Morris leaves. Said, what's it called? He said, Panky Panky. Tommy James. And Morris listened to the record. And Morris said, bring the kid in. And he's 14, Tommy. Wow. Tommy told me the story himself.
Yeah.
From his lips. And Tommy went in. And his first meeting with Morris, he walked in his office. And Morris had a guy named Big Nate. That he's a big, big, big guy.
Yeah, hence his moniker. Yeah.
And Tommy said, he walked in and Morris said, hey, kid. We got to take a ride. And so this is Tommy's introduction to the music business.
Right.
From Hanky Panky. And Morris said, come on, jump in the car. So they went out to New Jersey, and apparently somebody was bootlegging Morris's records.
Whoa.
Oh.
Yeah.
And Tommy said, they walked through the door right past the secretary into the factory, and Nate and Morris had a baseball bat smashing all the equipment.
Wow.
And obviously smashed the guy, too.
Oh, wow.
Holy
God. Ralph, those are your people.
They're the people who were bad. They were bootlegging.
Very, very familiar.
Bad boys.
Yeah, we were, I mentioned the name Joe Isgro, sort of the man that is best known for the payola scam, meaning that he would do many things.
I still don't know why that was illegal.
Let me explain. I had a program director, and it wasn't Scott Shannon. I guarantee you that. I'm not trying to save Scott. Scott was above board at all times. But I did have a program director that somehow enjoyed a free trip to Hawaii, all expenses paid, and I noticed some song on our playlist that we shouldn't be playing. And that was the great Joe Isgro. There were times at radio conventions that I was offered an album. I was given an album, and I'd say, oh, okay, I'm just trying to urinate here. Why am I? Well, look inside. And there was a bunch of white stuff inside the album. This happened one day. And I said, I'm not your guy. I don't do cocaine. So I'm the wrong guy. And to this day, I've never done it. Does it make me better than everyone else? Yeah, it does.
Damn, but, I wish I was in that.
No.
Makes you healthier.
No. Well, I don't know. But, you know, coffee has always been my thing. If I
so
really
if there were $100 bills in
thing.
That album?
Yeah, that's different. But the point is, no. But I never took payola, but they only knew that because I had influence at major radio stations, and that's the way Joe Isgro's company worked. And by the way, you know, it's up to the friggin' idiot stick who is working at the station to say yes or no. So I don't know. I think Joe, you know, Joe Isgro certainly paid the price.
It's creative marketing.
Did he not? I mean, he did. I'm so glad to hear that he's still around. I wasn't even aware that he's got to be in his 80s now, right, Joel?
I would say late 70s, early 80s. I'm having lunch with him next week.
Well, you can't turn Joe Isgro down.
No, you don't say no.
No. But you're also a man who produced one of my favorite guys, Engelbert Humperdinck. But not just any of his songs. Wasn't it you behind After the Lovin'?
I produced After the Lovin'.
That was his biggest hit of all time.
It was his only gold record ever had, including Release Me. His only gold record he ever had.
Massive.
And it was also number one jukebox record of the year. Number one sheet music seller of the year. I owned the copyright.
You're listening to... And Magic Matt.
That's Inge. That's it. That his friends call him Inge, right? That's,
yeah. Yeah. Was that his voice?
Let's hear that again.
Hi, this is Engelbert Humperdinck. Hey, Matt, do you want to know what I think is magic? My new Christmas album. Play it.
I produced his two Christmas albums.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know.
Somebody asked me a couple months ago, how many records did you produce with Engelbert Humperdinck? And I really didn't know. I actually counted them. I produced 109 recordings.
Holy crap, man. That's huge.
Yeah.
And we were talking about Inge before you showed up here on the show, and I'm so glad you're here. And the fact that he is one of the last crooners standing. There, I can only count another one, Jack Jones.
I love Jack.
Do you? I
Me
do, too.
Too.
Yeah. I do, too,
he's
man.
Good, he's a good buddy of mine.
Yeah, girl talk.
Girl talk.
Girl talk.
By the way, hey, Joel. Do you think Girl Talk could be released today? Do you think that how do you think the woke crowd, in fact, here, punch it in, girl, and then it'll come up there. Well, here's some of the lyrics, and then Joel, what the hell was that? I guess that's my producer leaving. that's what it sounded like.
I'm right behind him.
But this is... Okay, so now listen to some of these lyrics, and you tell me, Joel Diamond, the man who has produced the greatest songs in the history of music, you tell me, could this be released today?
They like to chat about the dresses they will wear tonight. They chew the fat about their dresses and the neighbors fight.
Great song.
Inconsequential things that men don't really care to know.
Whoa.
Become essential things that women find so apropos. But that's a dame, they're all the same. It's just a game, they call it girl talk. They all meow about the ups and downs
meow.
Of all their friends.
Pronoun.
The who, the how, the why, they dish the dirt, it never ends.
Never ends.
The weaker sex, the speaker sex, we mortal males behold.
Weaker sex?
But though we joke, we wouldn't trade you for a ton of gold.
Got that right.
So baby, stay and gab away. But him
gab
say
away.
that after girl talk to me.
Okay, so couldn't be released today. You could? Could you imagine the backlash of those lyrics? Joel Diamond?
Yeah, totally, yeah, of course.
Right?
Of course.
We'd be hung.
And
of
that's,
course.
Yeah, and that's and that is, I am hung, not one to boast.
Wow.
That is.
Set you up for that one.
That is.
Man, if I would have said that.
No, I'm 17 years old. Just, no, I am. Maybe 16 at this point.
Nine.
But
that's Stormy Daniels quick.
You simply can't, and like the great comedians, a Seinfeld, for example. You know, he goes on record, and this guy ain't a right-winger in any way, shape, or form, but he's had enough of this crap. As he puts it, comedy is comedy is comedy. You should do whatever it is you need to do on stage, love it, hate it. Music, I think, is the same damn way. I mean, you know, all these rap songs about killing the cops and all that, that's totally acceptable. But yet, a Jack Jones song like that, Girl Talk, there's no way, Joel. You agree, right? There's no way that could be released today.
Yeah.
It's a call. It's cold outside. Same thing.
Oh, yeah. Well,
baby, it's cold outside.
Oh, yeah. Well, not the same thing.
Yeah, of course it is. Of course it is. Helen Reddy. I love that Australian broad. And by the way, I do call gals broads. And gals, females on this show, by and large, they endorse that. They hug that concept of being called a broad because they know it's not a put down.
I was going to say only the good.
It's ones. You're one of the guys. You're one of the girl. You're not offended. You know, you're not offended by the stupid crap. And Helen Reddy, was she a broad? Even though she's the one who did "I Am Woman." Mm-hmm. So who was Helen Reddy? You produced. What did you produce for Helen?
I produced her last album and her last chart single she ever had.
God bless you.
And you know the name Jeff Wald? That was her husband at the time.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a tumultuous marriage.
Yeah.
And Helen wound up and died at the Motion Picture Home.
I know that. Right down the street from us, man.
No. Yeah, me. I'm in Calabasas.
Calabasas.
Oh, you are in Calabasas.
Yeah. So it was. I mean, Jeff was hysterical. I mean, again, the most volatile marriage you ever saw in your life. And my last session with Helen, I walked out. It's like midnight. I walked outside. She was trying to run him over with her car.
Whoa!
Oh yeah.
Oh
yeah,
no yeah, way. Yeah.
So when after he got divorced, Jeff got remarried. So Jeff called me only a couple of years ago, actually.
Yeah.
And he said, I finally got I Am Woman, the movie, made.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. And he said, we're screening at the Motion Picture Home. And would you want to come down? I said, Jeff, how are you going to sit next to Helen and watch it? He says, well, she's got dementia, and now she forgets how much she hates me.
Oh, no way.
That's funny.
No way. Oh, man, what a treat. What a treat having this man with us. It does my heart good.
Joel, it does my heart good, too, buddy.
I can see.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I believe you're being sincere when you say that.
Oh, yeah.
I love that.
Totally.
I love this man. More with Joel Diamond, man. You think you've heard stories so far? Oh, no. More to come on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio. Thank you for being there.
I lie awake. I've gone to ground. I'm watching porn in my hotel dressing gown. The journey's long.
Neutron and search rated number one.
This is Outlaw Radio with Magic Matt, the man who is always right.
Not one to boast. Welcome back, my friends. Welcome back, my friendlies, to the Big Dog of Broadcasting, Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio on YouTube, on Rumble, on X. And you know what? Screw YouTube by subscribing to us. They hate us. So subscribe to us. We'll show them. They're only worth how many billion? We'll show them. Welcome back, my friends. Welcome back, my friendlies, to the sort of the fun spot on great radio stations throughout the nation. And on occasion, we have a man named Joel Diamond sitting here, not drinking, not smoking, but one thing I've noticed. He hasn't bitched about the cigar smoke even once in the hour and a half that he has been here.
He's in the music industry.
He is. Which means what, Mark?
He's used to it, probably.
I'm immune to it.
He's immune.
Right. That's what that meant, Matt.
Oh. I know, but your statement is so effing stupid.
I know, everything
stupid.
Is today.
No,
is.
Not...
Well, oh, yeah, that's why.
Is
that's
it
why.
Everything?
Yeah, it's everything.
Am I jealous of you?
Yeah.
Okay, then let's continue. Yeah, that's
we
my...
We got that out of the way.
Okay, good. Sorry. Yes, I am. Wow. And I have much
Ralph,
to be jealous about.
Next week, man, because I am out.
Okay, so he relinquished his chair last week. He's doing it again this week.
Well, wait, so, can I take the chair? You can set the spot. Because I do like the chair.
It's Dave's chair.
So, hey, Marty, like the door is right there.
Hold on. So my brother, Marty, is going to take the chair.
Yes, I have to take the
but,
chair.
So I guess you have to stand.
That's fine.
Yeah, okay,
I'll
okay.
Find your own chair.
Joel Diamond, the man who has offered a recording contract to Stormy Daniels and has yet to hear from Stormy or her people. Does Stormy Daniels have people? She has people?
She has people.
She does. She has people. So you need to hear back from her people.
Yeah.
But all she must do is a rendition of More, More, More by Andrea True, which was a number four, which, you know, let's not mince things here. Number four, number one, it's within a couple friggin', you know, hundred. But the number four song in the United States in the 70s, why wouldn't Stormy Daniels take it? Yeah, Ralph?
I don't want to give away where Joe lives, but Stormy lives in Calabasas. I can tell you exactly where.
No, is that right?
Yeah.
Is that
yeah,
right,
Calabasas? Yeah, she lives in Calabasas. Wait,
and Stormy guess what? If she were to do it?
Yes, she does.
Get out of
does
here.
Does she rent Calabasas, Cali?
Yeah. Yep.
So not far from where we do our thing here
serious?
In the San
Francisco.
I am 100% serious.
Is that right?
Yes.
And guess what? If she were to
that.
Do this, which yeah. I think she will, I think it's going to be
she
hotter.
She can do the song at Outlaw Radio.
I got to tell
now
you
she
something.
She should premiere it here.
No. Joel Diamond, I gotta tell you something. If
why,
you would,
why didn't you tell me that soon?
Yeah, I know. If you
I was letting it breathe, Joel.
Joel, she's in the Toluca Lake UCLA medical place.
Joel Diamond, if you had known that, you could have talked, you could have knocked on her door, and I know you
I
because
been,
you,
yeah, I could have been driving up down with the speaker and the loud speaker. Stormy, where are you?
Stormy!
Come out wherever you want,
Stormy. Joel Diamond, you seem to be a bit precocious, and a man that is not afraid of much, right. And I think that you would knock on her door. Am I wrong?
You're right.
Yeah, I know that. I know that.
And when I lived in New York City in the penthouse, and then next building in
the
penthouse.
The penthouse.
No, I'm going to say, the penthouse next door was Candace Bergen.
No.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I used to deliver flowers to the doorman every day. I wanted a date with her.
Oh, by the way, Joel, what was the movie? Last Picture Show. What was she the hottest female on the planet?
Oh.
In
of
that,
course.
Right?
Of course.
I mean, and so you were, and you never got together with Candace?
No.
Oh, that's.
I used to look for her because our terraces were.
Did you stalk her, Joel?
Well, he is a stalker.
Yes, yes, I did.
By the way, in the flowers, did the card say, I am the terrace across the street?
Oh, yeah.
Stalker,
I told her.
Stalker.
I told her I was next door in the penthouse.
Yeah, not the terrorist, the stalker.
Joel Diamond of Diamond Silver Blue Music Publishing Company. How'd you come up with that moniker, by the way?
When I started my label and my publishing company, I was dating this girl. I said, well, I have to come up with a good name. She said, why don't you do your hair and your eyes?
Yeah.
Silver Blue.
Oh, and that was it.
That was it. It was
See, you and I are such saps when it comes to females. I mean, I would be worth gazillions of dollars today if it weren't for females in my life. We do covet. You're going to hate the way I put this, but I have to say it this way. Agree or disagree. We both covet the vagina. We do or do not? Joel?
Well, there's other parts I like, too.
Dark meat or white meat?
That a boy. What?
What does that mean?
Now he's gone interracial.
Hey, Mark. By the way, Mark C.G. Boyer, I will tell you this from my heart. I don't give an F what color or religion they happen to be. I have a problem where I do covet lovely females.
And guess what? It's all pink.
Oh, God.
College radio.
Well,
the chair's out the door.
Yeah.
It is. You might have to take your chair.
That's not.
That'd be a bleep. Yeah, it is. That's a bleep. Please make a note of that. Yeah, it's just too stupid to put on our radio show. Yeah. I will tell you that that Joel Diamond, and you may scratch your noggin over this one. It's like, oh, man, I can't believe that you're talking about this guy from so many years ago. Well, you have to be of a certain age. In my opinion, and because I was influenced by my father, Gary, who happens to be, in my opinion, the greatest musician who ever lived and is still living, God bless his soul, plays every instrument, but not like Wayne Newton. And I love Wayne. And I love his stage performances in Vegas. But he would pick up a horn, play two notes, boom, put it down. My dad can play every instrument more than proficiently. The guy is a monster. Mm. And this man, when I was a child in Everett, Washington, he would talk about, in his opinion, the world's greatest singer. He said it was a man named Gary Puckett who had the greatest vocal range in the history of music. And you, my friend, didn't this put you on the map working with Gary Puckett?
It didn't put me on the map, but I love Gary. And I agree with you. He had one of the best voices. And I gave him his last hit record.
Which was?
This Girl's a Woman Now.
Pure... Wow. Brilliant.
As a matter of fact, last time he was on stage at Saban Theater, and he introduced me from the audience.
Wow. Is that right?
Yeah. He said, cool. I want you to meet the person that gave me my last hit record.
Nice.
Yeah.
That is
It's cool. Nice when people remember.
Yes, sir.
Well, I'll give you the
Tommy Mottola remembers. He gave me a chapter and a half. I gave him his first job in the music business.
That was beautiful,
Tommy Mottola. David Geffen remembers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I negotiated David's first $1 million deal he ever made.
I've had friends work with David, so that's another thing.
But this song is so pristine and so beautiful, and you produced that song. We're standing, or I'm standing, you're sitting, with a man that produced one of the greatest records of all time. I mean, that is pure brilliance.
Thank you.
And once again, though, I asked you this earlier. You didn't know? Just another song? You didn't know it was a huge hit?
No, you feel it's something you feel in your stomach and your gut, because Gary has had so many major hits, and when I heard this, when my writer wrote "This Girl's a Woman Now," I said, "This is a smash for Gary," and I didn't know Gary at
smart,
the time.
Smart, no kidding.
And I sent a demo. To Gary's manager, Gary's agent, Gary's mother, Gary's aunt, Gary's cousin,
right.
Everywhere until I finally got the call.
So you brought in the writer.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He's the same writer that wrote After the Living for me for Engelbert.
God.
Wow.
Same writer, yeah.
Is he still around, the writer?
No.
Oh, boy.
No, he's gone.
How about this? From, I think, 1969. Because to me, it always sounded like a 70s song. And one of my favorites as a kid, you can't get enough of this song, because I think you followed that song from the great Gary Puckett up with Na Na Hey Hey, by a group named Steam. Kiss it goodbye. It is what... And a song that I've always referred to when folks talk about production.
I didn't produce that one. I'm singing on it.
Oh, so you suck then. Oh, God, I was so into this.
No, I'm singing. What happened...
Yeah?
It's a great little story, too. I was running Mercury Records Publishing at the time, and the writer and the producer is Paul Lecca, who also wrote and produced Green Tambourine, if you remember that.
Great song. Great production.
Paul's brilliant. So I was sitting in my office with Tommy Mottola. He was my assistant.
Right.
At the time.
By the way, Tommy Mottola, I mean, look him up when you get a chance after the show is over. The man is a magnate. The man is the isn't he the guy that married what's her
Mariah
name?
Carey.
I think, by the way, simply my opinion, I think she screwed that man over like there's no tomorrow.
Like all women.
The man, Tommy Mottola, gave her an effing career. And how does she thank Tommy? Nice chatting with you. That pisses me off to no end.
Yeah.
That's a man I've always had respect for. And because we're men, we're heterosexual males, we love the gorgeous female form, we are duped so many times.
But man, she's a nutbag too.
Okay, I don't know her. You don't know her. Please, Joel.
Hey, I don't want to say anything bad about her.
I understand that.
But
Steam's number one song.
So we're sitting in the office one night.
I just want you to know what song this is. Da, 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 goodbye.
It's like an anthem song. It's an anthem. So we're sitting in my office, and Paul calls downstairs. Paul Lecca. He's in the studio upstairs.
Wait, who? Paul who?
Paul Lecca.
Okay.
L-E-K-A.
Got it.
Great songwriter and producer, whatever. And he, like I said, Green Tambourine and a bunch of other stuff.
The best.
Yeah. And so he calls down. I said, I need some voices. I need background voices. I want just a bunch of voices. So I said, Tommy Mottola is sitting there. And he said, I'm wanting you guys to come up. So we even brought the janitor up.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So we walk into the studio, and it's like 20 of us standing there.
Yeah.
And I said, Paul, what do you want us to sing? And he said, well, I don't have lyrics yet. I said, so what the fuck are we going to sing? So he said, well, for time being, just sing Na Na Hey Hey Kiss Him Goodbye. And I said, okay. I could hear my voice.
Is that right?
So we're all going.
Wait, you're on this song.
Yeah.
Na 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 na, na 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 na, hey hey hey, goodbye.
I recognize that. That was you, Joel Diamond.
That was me.
So they were simply fill-in lyrics.
They were fill-ins.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, he didn't have any lyrics.
And it becomes a number one friggin' hit.
Everywhere in the world.
I think it was 1969. I always thought it was, it sounds 70s, sort of ahead of its time, and it was huge. You also, though, what did you do for I'm Gonna Make You Love Me, Supremes, Temptations? Great friggin' song.
I was the publisher of that.
Uh-huh.
I was the publisher when I was at Mercury Records. I was publishing that.
Cha-ching.
Song. Yeah.
So there's nothing you haven't done in the music industry.
I produced, I managed, I was an artist. Yeah, I write.
Triple threat.
I write also.
Besides wanting Stormy Daniels to sign your deal where she sings More, 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 the classic Andrea True, what is it you would love... You know, at this stage of your life, what is it you haven't done that you would love to do?
Well, just as a news break for you, I got interviewed a couple of weeks ago. I did a lot. Normally, I audition, but I was auditioned by the casting director for Golden Bachelor.
Oh, kidding.
That's great.
Wow.
That is great. So...
Would you take it?
Oh, yeah.
He said he auditioned.
Why?
Why not?
That's why you auditioned.
But that's what he said.
Hey, Matt, let me interrupt for a second. I just want to tell you from the YouTube gang.
Tattoo Dave, yes.
This is one of Magic Matt's best shows, listening to Joel Diamond's stories.
Yeah, well, I know.
Are you serious?
This is becoming really big.
Believe me, I know this in my heart. See, this is my gut. I've done this radio thing a couple years. And I know this Joel Diamond is the great. We could do another 4 hours with him. And by the way, God willing, at some time in the future, that would be pure awesomeness.
Sure.
I love him. Okay, we'll be this after back with the last segment with this incredible man named Joel Diamond. Not only an accomplished music producer, and as we've established, done everything in the business, but simply a nice guy. And that's, I'll tell you what, that's few and far between these days, man. Joel, I love you. We'll be this after back on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio.
Somewhere out there in the sagebrush and cow pies, the buzzard circles. and manly men start talking. Tear off a barbecue pork rib, have a drink, pick at their teeth, and top it off with a good cigar. Smoking, drinking, interrupting. Magic Matt Allen. This is Outlaw Radio.
Ah, there it is. There it is. More, more, more. More, more, more. Stormy Daniels. The man that sort of offered old Stormster an opportunity to sing. Sing this song. Made a huge hit by...
Were your ears bleeding? They were, right?
What?
Your ears are bleeding.
Are your ears bleeding?
No.
Yeah, by the great Andrea True and her connection so many years ago. Number four massive top ten hit years ago. And this man simply offered her the opportunity to sing this song. And I don't understand why. What possible explanation for saying no would Stormy Daniels? What else does she have going on except the tethering with Donald Trump? Nothing. And as this man, Joel Diamond, has pointed out, this will outlive all of that Trump, Stormy stuff, and she'll have a hit record. And I know she will, because you will make her sound great.
Oh, yeah. And she'll do things from the recording and the hit record that she could not have done before. Another way to show her goods.
Her goods? Oh, yeah. Oh, I saw some of her goods yesterday. I did the research, so you, my friends, don't have to. Oh, yeah. Boy, I'll tell you one thing. All right. Where's that song, Not Going Away? Didn't we already do that? Yeah. Okay. Andrea True. And by the way, God bless her soul. She was... Did you keep in touch with her in Florida?
Yes, I did.
You did?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Did you know that she was sort of on her demise, or did her death come as...
No, it was kind of a surprise to me.
It was.
Because she was
sort of doing good things. She went through rehab, and she had her own rehab clinic, I think, there in Florida.
I don't know if
But she was doing good stuff, and God rest her soul.
Yeah.
I have a question, which is sort of a non sequitur of this great man, and it's simply this. Why, Joel Diamond, why is Neil Sedaka not yet in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Help me.
That certainly is a non sequitur. Neil's a good buddy of mine, too. As a matter of fact.
You've never had this conversation with him?
No, no.
All right.
No, I'm trying to get Benny into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Listen. With all due respect to Benny Mardonis?
No, Neil's had a lot of hits, no question.
Neil deserves to be there.
He does. Of course he does.
By the way, there was some talk about a year ago, Magic Matt should be in the Radio Hall of Fame. Yes. Is that true? And yes, I should. But I heard that Shadow Stevens was not in the Radio Hall of Fame, and I said, wait a second. Shadow needs to be in there before me.
Yeah.
He must be in there before me.
Yeah.
Neil Sedaka should be in the Rock and Roll Stinking Hall of Fame before Benny Mardonis.
Of course.
Yes.
Of course.
But
Neil,
did he piss people off?
No, I don't think so. I don't even know. You're right. I don't know why he is not.
It doesn't make sense, does it?
Not at all.
We have been discussing the music business and other things with a man who knows Clive Davis personally. In fact,
he was my mentor.
I bet he was my buddy and your buddy Tony Orlando's mentor as well.
Mm-hmm.
There's something about these people in the industry, and I guess if I'm talking to someone who is 22 years old out there, and you think, oh, old guys, screw them, you're wrong. This is how you learn. This is how you gain knowledge that is irreplaceable.
There's a couple guys out there who do have a thirst for what we're talking about. When I worked with Ray J, you know who Ray J is?
I don't, but you don't have to call him Ray J. You can call him Johnson.
Just don't call him Collect.
You know that bit?
You know, the old guy, old comedian.
Ray J is Brandy's brother.
Yeah.
And Ray J is the one solely responsible for Kim Kardashian's career.
Oh, is that right?
I know who you're talking about.
See, yeah. There's always somebody behind the scenes, man.
Look, he was not behind the scenes. He was in front of the scenes.
Oh, he was?
Big time.
Yeah, I never watched any of that Kardashian stuff.
The sex tape.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
He was the star.
And plus, Ray J's had hit.
I never saw it, Ralph.
Yes, he has.
I never watched any of it.
Yeah, but what I was going to say, Ray J and I were on the cover of Calabasas Style once.
Yeah.
When he came over, because he lives in Calabasas, so do I. And Ray J's one of those guys who has a thirst for the knowledge of back what we're talking about.
Yeah, right. that's what it's all about, man. Well, I hope we talked to something, you 22-year-olds. We probably have one 22-year-old who might be watching us, who might be listening to us. I love this man named Joel Diamond. I love Tattoo Dave.
Love you back.
Our producer, my brother Mark.
G.
Ralph Odierna. Mark C.G. Boyer. Joel Diamond, it has been nothing but a pleasure and a treat, and not a treatment today. You, my friend, live forever. We need you in this world.
Thank you so much.
We truly do, man.
An honor and a pleasure doing this show.
Love you, man. It sounded so flippant. Love you, man. I really love this guy.
No, I got you.
I will continue to be Magic Matt on Magic Matt's Outlaw Radio, on YouTube, on Rumble, on X, and the greatest radio stations in the world. Thank you for listening and taking the time to spend time with us every week. Until next week, as my buddy Milt Larson, creator of the Magic Castle, always told me, bumblebees can't fly.
Blue-collared boys and rednecks, we got love.